nights, and we do education, heli skiing, and film production work mostly. And really, we're just right here at the back door, so much of what we do is right here in your mountains, dealing with the weathers that you deal with and the snowpack that you deal with here and that sort of thing. So years ago, we decided that that Alaska was amazing to us, that Alaska was number one for deaths per capita, and we were just like, blown away by that. And we were already talking amongst the guys that, well, gosh, it seems like there's not much forecasting in the state and not much education being done. So we started a non-for-profit, and we started traveling all over the state teaching a thing called Be Snow Smart. And it was pretty wild. We did it November, December, driving the ice roads, and, you know, a semi goes by, it's like 1,000, you're like, finally see the road again. But we survived it, and it was pretty neat. It woke up a ton of people to want to do this. So now there's a ton of non-for-profits running around the state teaching avalanche education, and there's a lot of forecast centers now, and really, we've really lowered the stats. I mean, you're seeing it. People have not just learned, but they've realized that there should be a big part of this progression on protocol. Because, you know, I'll show you my presentation, kind of what I'm talking about, but we're ahead of ourselves. We truly are. And protocols need to catch up, and we need to just use really practical protocols. You need to prioritize your highest risks, is what I'm going to teach tonight. And I'm talking more about not fast-forwarding ourselves to airbags and safety equipment. The reality is an avalanche is trauma. I mean, you usually don't survive the ride. So being dug up is usually not that great of an outcome anyway. So let's face it, it's more about being in charge of our destiny and being our own forecasters and choosing the right day to go out or not go out, or choosing the right terrain to go out and that sort of thing. Because it's the little dominoes that lead up to big catastrophic avalanche. You know, we can all read about every accident, and usually it's some little tiny domino, a lost ski, a dog running off, a guy with way too big of a backpack, you know, twisting his knee way out far. So it's really, that's really what I'm talking about here, is engaging all of us, that we're actually the ones that really should evolve techniques and protocols. It's not up to a guide or a snow safety person or a forecast center. And I think a lot of people think it is. I think a lot of people can call a hotline and say, oh, we're good to go, let's go do whatever. But it's microclimates, and there's times when you feel better and you operate better when you're physically or mentally on your game, and there's times when conditions on the surface can cause incidents and accidents that can lead up to you having to traverse five big avalanche chutes just to get home. It's all fun and games until something goes wrong, and that's what I'm talking about more here, is just practical protocols. And I'm not going to fast forward to how to shovel and how to probe and how to use an avalanche transceiver, and that an airbag is going to save your life. I would say take advantage of technology, but don't let it be your demise. I think right now, protocol needs to catch up to where we're at, and I think we're all overly confident in the safety equipment and the technique and everything. And so really, that's what I'm talking about. Anything you guys can offer in this tonight at the end, or even in the middle, raise your hand. Shoot holes in it. It's all about engaging the idea and building this to be a better way of traveling in the mountains, expecting more of ourselves, our partners, and what we share with our families. Let me kick the lights on a little bit.
Okay.
So this all started years ago. When I first moved to Valdez, we wanted to get back to the community. We started this thing called Experience the Mountains. And the kids would be able to get to go and do a day of heli skiing if they showed up to the lecture. And what really got my attention was, we asked the kids, how many of you guys have seen somebody get caught in an avalanche or been caught in an avalanche? And like 80% of the room raised their hand. And it's really because Valdez has a road run, and it's right at the top of Thompson Pass, and it's like the worst wind load place you could ever want to ski. And that's where most people saw action. But I just couldn't believe it. After living in so many different places, like Telluride and Summit County and in Utah, and being in a place where there's hundreds, if not thousands, of people recreating on steep slopes. And I've never seen that many people raise their hands saying they've seen action. And that's what woke us up to, like, you know, let's do this. We'll create more work for our guides year round. We'll be able to give them a better portfolio, a better resume, so they can look better, they can make more money year round, they can be you know, I believe mountain guides, really skilled mountain guides that are really working hard and really done it for a long time, have a PhD in the mountains, and yet in the U.S. it's really not there yet. They should be making much more money. They should get much more respect. I mean, I see it all the time with ski resorts or at different conferences. Oh, look at the ski bum. And it's like, no, that's Mike. Mike is incredible. I mean, you guys got more knowledge than almost anyone I know. But that's what I think. That was a big part of why we started teaching and sharing. It's like, let's teach the public and let's teach educators really practical terrain management skills, traveling through the mountain skills. Let's have the people that do this day in and day out teach it. And, you know, we just thought that was so great and wonderful, and we did it. And now we do it all over the lower 48 and everything else, and we've won some awards for it. But, you know, we don't do it for any other reason but to try to help guides make a better living, try to see the protocols and techniques change a little bit more away from, you know, certification pocket in our pockets and safety equipment, but really truly train management skills. And can try to change this thinking that, you know, most courses I walk into, it's like a realtor, a retired realtor, teaching me a level two. You know, and yeah, he's got a lot of ski patrol experience, he's got some skills, but, you know, he's not the guy that, you know, is in these mountains, like a guy, your most guru guy that gets out in the back of your hoots or someone like that. What a great guy to teach this kind of stuff. So that's where it all started and all began, and it's evolved and morphed into the Steep Life Protocols. And Steep Life Protocols is definitely more about the lifestyle, protecting that lifestyle. You know, this is all of us out in the mountains and loving what we do, and it has amazing health benefits. And it keeps us connected and just puts us in the moment and creates amazing friendships. And it's so important. And I think if we evolve techniques and protocols and really focus on all of us helping one another as this moves forward, that's what makes us stay in it. You know, so many of us have dropped out. Many of my friends just don't even recreate outdoors much anymore, if at all, because of an incident or an accident, or it's just getting too overwhelming with all the equipment and all the buzz, and it's so expensive. But it really shouldn't be that way. But here's why we're ahead of ourselves. We're so lucky to be living at this time. Access is amazing. And I mean, just even this little ski hill here, or now road systems going into the mountains. I mean, there's pullouts nowadays in places that didn't exist. They're actually inviting you to go into the steeper, deeper terrain. Everyone from you know, Department of Transportation to different land agencies and everything else. But it doesn't mean it's a safe place, and that's where you have to be in charge of your own destiny. Oh, this is a pullout. It says I can park here. But at the end of the day, you can look up and say, wow, I bet an avalanche could hit this parking lot, and say, well, how parking in this parking lot? So that's what I'm talking about, is we're living in an amazing time. Resorts have opened up all this wild terrain of what we all wanted it. Side country and back country and snowmobiles and snowcats and helicopters, you're getting us out there so far, so fast. But we're just kind of putting the technique and all the high-tech stuff in front of just really good basic backcountry protocol. I mean, the sport demands a ton of respect, and I don't care if you're on a snow machine, on a snowboard, or skis. I mean, 0 to 80 miles an hour, we put our prosthetics on and we just become superhuman, like right then and there. And it just demands so much more respect. And I'm not just talking about avalanches, I'm talking about crashing or impacts or getting injured. You need to be a forecaster of not just avalanches, but of weather, snow condition. Pick the right group. If you don't have the right group, you pick the train accordingly. And so this is us. This is amazing that we get to have all these benefits from recreating outside, but if, gosh, what was it, 2 years ago, 3 years ago, 5 deaths before Christmas, all the deaths were avalanche-related inside ski resorts. And that's the trend. That's where it's going. I mean, here, Alaska is a good example. We've had 7 deaths in less than 3 years in Alaska in heli-skiing. That's insane to me. And 5 of them were on authorized use on federal lands. And I always say this to people, it's like, well, gosh, if people were to follow through and get permits, they wouldn't have to be flying out way beyond their means without radio repeaters on top of the mountain, without flight following, without a safety cache out there and all those things. 5 of those deaths were all on unauthorized lands, which means, you know, it's a good thing to have permits. It's a good thing to have to jump through those hoops on protocols to live up to what you're doing. And that's what needs to happen. I mean, in 22 years, we had seen two deaths in heli skiing, and they weren't even guided heli skiing. It was one kid who was selling tacos at the ABA parking lot up on Thompson Pass, and the helicopter company promised him a heli ride because they gave him free food all the time. And the heli brought him up, and he fell in a crevasse. And then another guy died at the World Extreme Skiing Championships. And then that's in 22 years, that's all we had seen in heli skiing and that kind of stuff. So now we're seeing it in resorts, we're seeing it in the backcountry, and we're seeing it in a lot of the guide services. And it truly just comes down to the protocols and techniques and traveling the mountains and giving it more respect than I think we're doing, including myself and others. And I can talk about that a little more as we go. So yeah, we're accessing the goods, all right? We're going out there further, deeper, faster than ever before. And not just that, we're being more remote. We're going off bigger, steeper, more blind terrain. I mean, even your ski tour, your cross-country skier guy, it's really rare that he's skiing down the skin track that he went up. So really, almost all of us are really kind of mechanized backcountry people. Because even if you don't ride in helicopters or snowcats or even ski lifts, you're using a highway system and you're getting deeper into the mid and high alpine terrain than you ever did before. And you're definitely, your technique is up, and you're definitely getting up on the ridge and cutting out to bigger, steeper, more blind terrain. And I'll just say this, is Snowbird, Utah. And I'm just gonna put this in your head right now. It's all about terrain management, route selection, visual verbal route selections and things like that, and I'll touch on that more. But just for example, this is Mount Baldy at Snowbird. And when they open it up, 1,000 people traverse across the top of the peak. And let's see, you see the traverse way up there? Mm-hmm. I'll find the pointer.
This other laser rope pointer has a pointer.
Broken coming over on the ferry with all the kids sitting on bags.
Oh, that one.
So you see the traverse, and you hike up the ridge a little ways right here, and then you cut across. I mean, it's pretty obvious that this is avalanche terrain. See all the trees, how they're barely surviving and getting ripped apart by avalanches? But that's not enough to get your attention. The type of terrain and the shape of terrain is what we should really be tapping into. Why is this avalanche? Where did this avalanche come from? Yeah, it comes from the concave. And this is where it's the worst. This is where it's like splitting an atom, and you get more energy and more power and more trauma than you ever thought possible. And it's just, hey, there's only a foot of snow. But these things fetch snow, so all of a sudden you got 4 feet of snow fetched in there from the wind, and then once it avalanches, it becomes one powerful mass. And I'm telling you, avalanche transceivers or airbags or anything else really isn't going to save you when you get hammered that hard. And this is in our ski area. This is nothing. And even if you're not going to ski this type of terrain in a ski area, guess what? The groomed run goes right below it. This one actually went out right on the groomed run. So the saying is, you're either in the right place of the mountains or the wrong place. And so, like, I skied with my kids at Snowbird for a couple of years. I mean, I wouldn't want to tell my kids I'd ski down and wait for them down here. No way. I don't want to be parking at the apex of this ridge where if anything happens, it's going away from where I'm standing. And there's a phone there, actually. We call it the phone at Snowbird. And hey, guys, we'll meet you at the phone. Let's not stop underneath the bowl. You know, just because some resort opened it up doesn't mean it's in a controlled environment. Absolutely, snow can never be controlled. It's way too dynamic. It operates at its own time. Yeah.
So before this would open for backcountry skiers, wouldn't the ski patrol or whoever shoot down the snow at the top of that?
They did. And here's one bomb here.
Yep.
And that's what I was doing. I was actually running snow. I actually ran this route. This avalanche was a 4-pound bomb. You can see this. So this was my first shot, second shot, and so on. But this thing slides all the time without explosives. And you cannot begin to control mountains with explosives. You can try, but like the guy at the World Extreme Skiing Championships years ago, the guy from Steamboat, they did that. We were blowing up the mountain, knocking cornices off, and some of it makes it stable, but also some of it makes it unstable. And it's like the guy at Aspen Highlands, you know, they threw multiple 5-pound bombs, it's good to go, and they ski it, and it climaxes. Snow demands people respecting the cycles, not totally going, oh, we controlled this has been skied 100 times. you know, things slide on the 100th skier or the 100th snowmobile or after 10 explosive charges. Oh, we've been bombing this all year. Snow is so dynamic, and it's just propagation factors that people don't talk about enough, but I'll talk about that more as we go. But, you know, just think about where you want to be in the mountains. Is this the place you want to be after a storm or a wind event, or when you see some rain falling, or when the temperatures increase? You know, this is what I'm talking about. Be an apex predator skier or backcountry guy. Get on the high points, the ridges and the hips, and I'll go over that more as we go. But I'm just saying that this is, oh, and driving up to Snowbird, there's a 120 avalanches pass that hit the road. So it's not just this guy that's an excellent skier or this guy's a black diamond skier. You just going up with your kids to teach them to ski for the first time, you got to be like, oh, there's a woman stuck in front of me. Do I park right here under the big chute, or do I park under the ridge system and sit there and go, should I, could I help her? Yeah, I probably can, but I should definitely park my family in a safe place before I go help her. So it's more about just talking about the terrain and the terrain management. You know, this is a Superior. This big thing buries the whole road and that parking lot. We're just living in an amazing time. We have had amazing access, and we can get after it, but it demands a higher level of protocol and more respect than ever before, because it's not just you out there anymore. There's 100 people possibly above you while you unload your car, or while you put your skins on your skis, or while you get your snowmobile unstuck, whatever it may be. Once again, this is under the tram cables at Snowbird, and once again, we bombed all this, guys. We bombed everything. This went naturally, and after we ran the routes, we see the bombs from here, boom, boom, boom. This thing went naturally overnight. And the same goes, like, you know, here's this slight concave. Where would you want to be? There's a reason those trees survived there. That's where you want to be hanging, or where you want to be skiing toward, or snow machining toward, or whatever it may be. And, you know, where's it going to take you? What's it going to take you into? So all these things add up. And this is just an example of what we're dealing with, and why we need practical terrain management protocols to lead us in the mountains, not trusting an avalanche transceiver or trusting an avalanche forecast. You got to, every ridge you go over, every bowl that you enter, every canyon that you go into demands a whole nother advantage of a forecast. You can't just say a Wasatch is this or the Chugach range is this. Not the case. There's so much microclimate stuff going on. And to talk about the Chugach, I mean, probably the most diverse microclimate place I've ever worked. I mean, just with the surface or and winds and temperatures and all the things that happen in these mountains, it can snow 6 feet in one valley and only 2 feet in another, just 2 miles away. Well, we're going to the valley with 2 feet, not six, you know. So just tapping into that. And here's the deal. These guys are just tromping away and storming up these mountains. It's not just you that could affect your life or your family or your friend's life. You got all these people out there nowadays doing it. And, like, this is kind of a good example to look at. What in this photo, first of all, no one's got a pack, probably not a transceiver or a shovel or probe, and they are going into what I would consider like backcountry terrain. Just because it's in a ski resort doesn't mean it's not backcountry terrain. It's all got the same angle, and it all has the same snow, and while people are trying to control it, that's just not enough, because you got all these other people and yahoos out there that could cause problems for you. But what about thinking about what's happening in this after the storm? You can just see there's new snow that's fallen. You can see the wind was associated with it. You can see the cornices were breaking off throughout the storm. And I'm just going to start tapping into strikes. I call it strike 3 methodology, and how you choose terrain and how far, how deep you're willing to go in the mountains, or if you should go at all, because you just have to anymore. It's just really getting pretty wild out there. I mean, you're going deep on either a helicopter, or you're going 4 bowls in, or you're going to Jackson Hole and you're in a 3rd bowl back. I mean, it doesn't take long before you're actually in a real situation. The lift breaks, a big avalanche occurs. It all comes down to your techniques and knowledge and everything else. So, you know, the level is high, and these guys are above you, or they're your partners, and you're kind of getting sucked into the mountains going, yeah, I really want to ski that big run, I really want to ski that big run, I'm with the right group, you know, it's not just that you know, you might be pressured to go do stuff you're not ready for, or go get pressured and trust someone like me that, oh, he's a guide, he knows what's up. I mean, I get a kid like Seth Morrison to show up to Valdez or Sage. They almost say, look at me as a red flag. Like, eh, Dean's been doing this a long time, he's filmed a lot of movies, blah, blah, blah. Hey, Dean, I'm not looking at doing the biggest, steepest thing today. And I'm like, yeah, Seth Morrison could probably ski anything. He has respect for mountains. Yeah, I hear you, Seth. Let's go out and take a look at the mountains and let's walk before we run. You know, some athletes don't say that. You know, they show up, oh, I want to ski that. You're like, 65 degrees, south-facing, solid ice. How could you even say that? But it's the level's high, and the feeding frenzy's just going nuts. I mean, this is what's happening all around us in the mountains nowadays. This is Mount Francis and Valdez. I mean, this was 70 degree slope, an 80 foot jump onto a 50 degree slope. I did. It took me 22 years to do it, but it hit me later. You're like, what a concept. In the world, or, you know, how did we get so far into this sport and so into these mountains? But the point is that we're so extreme in doing stuff. The point is the level's so high that protocols need to catch up, and that we also need to be aware of who we're going with and what they're doing, and say make the call. Everyone's decision matters in the mountains. So this is kind of what hit years ago. We were looking at getting more involved with education and things like that. We pulled this up, and Alaska was number one at the time. And it was just like, how could Alaska be number one? There's more people recreating in the Wasatch Mountains on a given day than people are recreating in the whole year in Alaska out in steep terrain. And that's what jumped us into educating and wanting to try to make a difference. And we kind of knew this too, that the more we needed to learn too. So it was like kind of forcing the idea that the more you teach, the more you learn, and the more respect you get for the mountains. But it's not up to me or an Avalanche Center or anyone else really anymore. It's up to us, because if we don't all come together, engage the idea, and develop protocols, really practical protocols and things like that, we're going to start seeing access being compromised. I mean, there's going to be gates at ski resorts that are not going to be open in the future if the accidents and incidents keep on the rise. Permits are going to be hard to obtain. It's going to be amazing. These 7 deaths in Alaska, it's a big deal. I mean, OSHA's now involved and everything else, and it's a pretty big distraction from kind of folks on really practical train management protocols. When you have to test everybody's eyes and everybody's ears and do the whole OSHA thing now. Not that it doesn't make the company better, but you know, that's kind of not the direction it needs to go. The direction needs to go.
We'll stay on that graph for a second. Just, do you have any thoughts on why California is the lowest of the western states, you know, with a huge population?
It's not anymore. this is a very old graph. California is probably in fourth or fifth now, because that year they had all those people killed, right? There was 2 in California that year before Christmas. And now California's had a lot of deaths in Avalanches, a bunch. Last 2 years they've been safe because they haven't gotten any snow, but let's hope some polar air goes down with El Nino. But education makes the difference, and assessing from the top down is what I'm talking about. So how do you assess from the top down? Well, you got to have the right route, and this route has to provide you the ability to reassess the snowpack on the go at different aspects and different elevations. You can't dig a snow pit at the top of a big avalanche chute and deemed it safe, and you can just ski the gut. I mean, Silverton Resort's kind of like that. I went up there, I had 17 clients, it was at New Year's. I was like, what's on the ground? All faceted, 17 inches of just sugar graphite on the ground. And I'm like, man, if it blows or snows, we're gonna see avalanche. Sure enough, it snows 19 inches overnight. And I'm just taking the clients down the most mellow stuff I could possibly find, just glades under the lift, kind of. It's a hard place to find moderate terrain. And they were gonna hang me. It was like the 4th run in the morning. And they're like, one guy's like, hey Dean, we did not come to Silverton to ski low angle terrain. I mean, their logo is a guy falling off a cliff. We came here because of that. And as a mountain guy, you're gonna go, yeah, I get it. I go, trust me guys, this is not the day to ski anything that's concave, convex, unsupported slope, or a terrain trap, anything that has real angle. And at 10 a.m. they threw a bomb, and the percussion sent off like 10 avalanches within 4 miles. Just the percussion of that one bomb. And then we watched like 90 avalanches occur for about an hour from the top. And then they were like, yeah, we totally get it. But so that's what it's about. I'm just going to talk more about terrain management and top-down protocols. Because that's really what we're all talking about anymore. Like, I would love to see like an association that's inclusive, that every resort, every snowcat company, and every helicopter can become a member of, and start engaging more of this bigger picture of route selection, of top-down terrain management protocols, and remain visual and verbal with your partners, so you can keep the gears engaged and do have the buddy system for making the right decisions and for a rescue situation. But here's how we have to start out. First of all, you have to say the mountains always win. And, you know, that's great. I mean, when I get, like, a snow safety guy, you know, I was down in Silverton last year, and I worked with a couple different people, and there's a big difference when someone walks up, and you can tell that they're so humbled by the mountains, and they remember every single person that's ever been lost that they've been a part of, and they don't take it for granted at all, and they say that. And that would be like your Seth Morrisons and guys like that. But let's go back to looking at this photo. It's a massive avalanche. This is a highway. This is a two-lane road here. And this guy's driving up in the spring after the road just got open. And they saw some mountain goats up on the cliff. Let's take a picture, honey. They get out to take a picture of the mountain goats, and this big monster comes down the mountain. Why are they safe? And where did this avalanche come from? He came from that big concave, that big toilet bowl. Where something gets flushed, what do you do? Where do you go? Really nowhere, right? There's nowhere to go.
Where is it taken?
This is in Montana.
Is it Lovett Pass?
This is a big concave. This is a huge bowl. And this is where some places in the world, it's the only place where they're skiing, because it's the only place that fetches snow, right? Colorado, for example, places like that. But then you just got to think about not giving yourself to it and not jumping into the gut of every bowl and every chute. But I'm not sure the name of it.
I think it's going to the Sun Road on the way up the Logan Pass.
But here's kind of what I try to teach the guys and what I try to share in my educational programs is look at the mountains three-dimensional and put topo lines on it. And this is a really good peak. This is about 4,000 vertical feet. It's called Skate Park in Valdez, Alaska. And you can just start looking at places that are the big concaves. Huge concave, huge concave. All these concaves are where the big monsters come out and where they become so powerful. And then start looking at all the unsupported slopes. Unsupported slope, unsupported slope. Unsupported small slope, big unsupported slope up here. And, you know, when I talk about unsupported slopes, and I'm going to touch on a little bit later, snow has the ability to have some structural value stacking on itself. Now take that away and add some weak layers, you know. So that's why unsupported slopes are such a big deal. And convexes. So all your convexes up here, I mean, these are the places you have to identify your convexes. You come up to a bowling ball, you just have to know that gravity's playing a much bigger role. And that snow is actually moving. Add tension, and what do you get? So think about the routes you want to be doing. Hiking, skiing, snowmobiling, whatever it may be. You know, you want to be an apex person. You want to be up here in case something happens, it goes away from you. And instead of spot that person, it's so much better to be like, wow, did you see that? Wow, those things are massive, huh? Look how impressive that avalanche is. You know, how do you get down this mountain? Wouldn't you rather be connecting the dots and going safe zone to safe zone? If you are going to ski the gut and you can trust it, wouldn't you rather be ski down and then one guy parks up here and the next guy goes and so on? You just keep working. You get another vantage point. You get to be able to reassess the snow by digging into it and looking at it. And you can maintain visual and or verbal. So think about this. Concave is the big ball, the big chute, the place where snow just funnels in, becomes so powerful. The convex is where snow is hanging and gravity's playing a much bigger role. So what's 10 feet of snow weigh? 400 feet across? So much weight. And so just think about how much gravity's really playing a role in that concave, or that convex. And then unsupported slopes. These are the three places that are sliding and getting up 90% of the people. And people aren't really identifying that. They're so focused on the transceiver, the probe, the shovel, the airbag, the snow pack, looking at it from a scientific way of But really, you can't. You can use all that stuff and take advantage of technology, but man, keep it right back to visual verbal route selections. Does your route provide the ability to reassess and see below you and see your partner the whole time and be able to re-engage the conversation at a place to say, what do you think? That's what we're talking about. And then train traps, you know, this is the big number four where it stacks up on you so big that you don't really stand a chance. And this would be, you know, pretty wicked train trap down here, steep to flat. Alaska's been pretty lucky with a lot of the avalanches that have occurred with a lot of some of the big dome companies and stuff. It's because a lot of our slopes have a beautiful dissipation factor. And that's why Alaska's lucked out in a lot of ways over the years. But then again, maybe the guys are selecting those kinds of slopes. Maybe the pro athletes are selecting those kinds of slopes too. So some of it comes down to good protocol. So you know, you start looking at where things slide, and that is a wicked terrain trap. That's a pretty small little slope, probably 400 feet, but just see how much it stacks up. You don't stand a chance. It just stacks up 12 to 15 feet deep. That's a tiny little avalanche in the big picture, but not the deposition. The deposition becomes something quite massive. It would be hard to rescue somebody off underneath that with an avalanche transceiver. Their odds are really, really not good to really think about it. And you start looking at some of this, you know, concave. It almost always will be this way when we look around the mountains, unsupported. And a lot of times these little, and I'll talk more about this later, but a lot of times it's, a lot of times these are buried and they're hidden and they might look something like that. It might just look like cottage cheese or wavy gravy. And you're like 2,000 foot slope, perfectly nice, beautiful 1,000 feet of skiing, and then halfway down there's a bush line growing across it, or a ripe reef of rock. It doesn't have to be a cliff to make it unsupported. Anything that breaks the continuity of the snowpack and allows the snow to rot out or the cold temps to get in and cause metamorphosis and break down the crystals, it will make it unsupported. It gives us a chance to fracture and get some speed and really release is what it does. So, strike three methodology, and I'll just back up. This was Silverton that one day that I was there, or that week I was there years ago. I think it was our second year in business. And I mean, everything slid. I mean, everything that should slide didn't slide. And start looking at the mountains at where avalanches occur and where they don't occur. Like, why are these trees looking pretty healthy? That's where I would want to be, personally. Do I really want to be in these trees that have no branches facing uphill, that have scars on the back side of the tree, on the uphill side of the tree? No, I'm identifying that, wow, we got a new storm. I'm in Silverton. The snowpack was horrible before the storm. Where do I need to go pick my skin trap? Or my ski, where I'm going to ski down? So, and it all, of course, isn't a train trap. So, Let me just explain the strike three methodology. There's times you go in the mountains, there's times you don't go, and you have to be in charge of your own destiny to make that call. It cannot be a guide or a forecast center. You really have to be like, you know, mentally, physically, how do I feel? Make the call based on simple, basic stuff. Because you're the ones that lead up to big domino avalanches. The equipment you're using, the weather, the surface of the snow condition. It may not even be an avalanche you're trying to worry about. It's just the overall safety of everything. Slide for life, sliding down into some rocks, really catchy, trippy snow, sun crust that blows your knee, and the next thing you know, you're like, well, we have no choice. We're going to have to traverse out of here, Jim, and we're going to have to cross all six slide paths so we can get back to the ski hill so we can get deep back down in the car. It's the little things that lead you into breaking rules out there that matter a lot. So strike three methodology that I'm going to share with you is not just about avalanches. It's about, you know, just giving the mountains a lot more respect and having a really good way of striking away on what you're willing to do on a given day. So mentally, physically, you can figure that one out. Decide, today's just not the day to go ski Mount Francis or go ski off the steeper side of the resort over here. Or the gear. You know, we all meet up at the bottom, we meet up at the cars, and I show up with my old leather boots. And you're like, wow, Dean, you like those boots from 1930s, huh? Like, yeah, I love these things. Wow, it's pretty bad wind slabs up there, a lot of sun crust. You know, that could just be a strike. And the group's like, you know what, guys, why don't we just go ski this other area? So a little more, not as complicated, a lot safer. it could be the guy showing up with a 30-pound pack. You're like, gosh, Jim, do you really think you can ski? You know, what we're about to ski with that big angry midget on your back? It's just like, you know, it's, that's what gets you, is all these little things. And then the group dynamics. And then Harry shows up. Harry's your big extreme skier, jumps off everything. And you're like, all right, strike one, the boots, strike two, the conditions up in the mountains. Strike three, here comes Frank with his extreme attitude. And he was out all night long. Whatever it is, you need to make a call on what you're willing to do on that given day. How far, how steep, how deep are you willing to go based on all these variables? So let's just say this. Strike through methodology and avalanche terrain is, I'm just going to share like the four places where I see people having the biggest action. Concave, convex, unsupported sloping terrain trap. And what are the four things that cause avalanches? New snow adds weight. What was on the ground before that new snow? You can predict tomorrow's avalanche by paying attention to what's on the ground today. What about this stuff? Sun crust or super wind buffed out snow. You can say to your son, man, son, if it snows on top of this, I bet we're going to see some massive avalanches. And you already have made a forecast and a prediction on what's going to happen next. And you'd be hopefully respecting that and saying what you're going to do and not do in the next storm. Or let's say you're walking in the snow, and it's just rotten sugar. It's been out 30 below. All the snow's just turned to graphite. You can't even make a snowball out of it, right? It just feels like graphite. Is it going to hold a storm, next storm? Wind. Wind can load slopes massively quickly and causes tension. And people don't talk about tension enough. I mean, I see guys, AMGA guides, and all these people digging snow pits and doing shears and all this. Oh, easy shear. Wow. I guess we're not going skiing, huh? Yeah, no, that's a bad shear. I'm like, what's going to cause the avalanche? The shear? You know, it's not the shear. It's the ability to propagate a fracture line, right? So one thing you want to tap into more than anything else is fracture lines. Wake up, look across the village, look across town, and go, wow, all the new snow on the roofs has cracks. It has tension, it has fractures. Go to the car, the hood of the car, it's been parked in front of Alta for 3 days, and you want to go get the snow off it, don't just clear the snow off it, get some information. Slam your arm into it. Does a spider crack in four directions and slide off the car with a ton of energy? Or the big mushroom rock out by the parking lot, it's got the whole year's accumulation on it. There's your perfect isolated column. But it's more information because you can get more physical with it. You're gonna hear the tension if it's in there. Slam your arm into it and see if it spider cracks in four directions. Anything you can do to try to get a handle on what's going on, tension's a big deal. So wind is a biggie, and people don't give it enough respect. It can load slopes massively quickly. And then increasing temperature, right? You can take consolidated snow and turn it unconsolidated. And then rain. And rain's becoming a bigger factor. And a lot of times what people are missing nowadays is rain and warming temps is the climate change is real. And all of a sudden, 4 weeks ago in Whistler, Canada, it rained 4 inches a day for 5 days. And then it snowed 12 feet on top of it. And I'm kind of looking back in the data going, did it ever freeze? And I'm looking at it, no, it stayed 50 degrees and then all of a sudden it started snowing. I would show up to Whistler, Canada going, I bet there's a high chance of a really deep release here. And we got wind and 10 feet of snow over the last course. So just think about the big four. Concave, convex, unsupported slope, and terrain trap is the terrain that's getting most people nowadays. And you can start picking when you ski those things and when you don't by looking at the four things that cause avalanches. New snow, wind, increasing temperature, and rain. And you can start striking away. Take the strikes with you of the partner that's hungover, the partner that's overly aggressive, or the mountain guy that's just, you know, you think you might be pulling in mountains too steep, too deep. Whatever it is, just start striking what you won't do. Here's what I always do is I say, strike one based on my concerns with stability. It snowed 2 feet of snow. I'm like, okay, I drive up to Thompson Pass, I get my skis out, I put my skins on. I'm looking for anything on the drive or anything on my climb up the mountain that's gonna give me the strike two. A strike one is, I can ski some pretty fun terrain, but I'm looking more for isolated, more micro type terrain, concave, convex, unsupported slopes. I'm not looking for anything big. I want something that's as quick as I'm skiing and bam, to the safe zone. and it's pretty amazing. It's even more fun because it's more dynamic, it's more complex. It's more teamwork to ski that type of terrain. It's pretty fun, but at least I'm not going to give myself to something major. So, you know, I always say this, on a strike one day, I want to be at least visual with my partner and be able to get to my partner within like 5 to 8 minutes. Which means, does this run provide me safe zones to regroup and meet up with my partner? And then at the top of the mountain, we had talked about our plan. And that's like, hey, look, we're going to ski this chute. The snow looks amazing and fun. How about if I go down first, if I like everything and the snow felt good to me, I'll put 2 poles up. That means I liked it. Come on down. My eyes are on you and I'm watching you. And you ski down. Great. Oh, that was epic. That was great. We come in, we regroup, we talk about the snowpack, what's below us. We maybe dig a hasty pit. We maybe stomp around a little bit, test the snow a little bit before we jump right into the chute, whatever it may be. How about this? I ski down on this same day, the next day, same scenario, and the slope cracks, a big fracture line. It settles, but doesn't slide. And I get down to the safe zone. I'm like, whoa, if I couldn't communicate with you, wouldn't that be a bummer? But I can because we've predetermined some hand signals. 2 poles means I like the snow, come on down, let's regroup here. Crossing the poles means stop, something's wrong. I'll probably be climbing out of here pretty soon. Or you might take the ridge home and I might have to go a different way and we'll just try to stay visual as possible, whatever it is. Or I might just point, and I point my ski pole this way, you traverse left, and my hand drops here online. And that way you can still be on the spot where you want to be. You ski over to the top of the apex of the ridge, and you ski down on the ridge. It wasn't as good as skiing, of course, because it wasn't that nice big chute, but you ski down, you're like, what was up? And I'm like, man, take a look back. And my track has these 3 big cracks across it, and you can see the whole slope settle. It just didn't take off. But I'd feel like a real jerk if I couldn't warn you or communicate. So strike one, to me, is I have some concerns about avalanches, and I can ski some pretty neat stuff, but I do not want to be in a huge bowl, a huge face, a big chute, big convex, or a big unsupported slope. And I definitely don't want to go through a train trap. If I don't have to. If we have to, we want to do it one at a time and have the safety equipment and spot one another. Because sometimes you have no choice but to have to get through a train track down the bottom of the valley or whatever it may be. But strike 2 day would be, we had an epic day that day and it starts blowing overnight. 60 miles an hour up in the mountains above Cordova. And you're sitting in the kitchen with your wife and you're going, I think it's strike 2 for tomorrow already. And or maybe not. Maybe you need to wake up and see the mountains to make that call, whatever it is. The strike 2 to me personally is like no concave, no convex, no unsupported slope, and no terrain trap. And yet in the Rocky Mountains or mountains of this magnitude, there is a lot of amazingly fun terrain to go ski. A big long ridge system on top of the apex of the ridge, a low angle terrain, trees that prove they don't slide much if at all because they have branches facing uphill. I'm looking for low angle terrain. I'm looking for places with great anchoring. I'm looking for places where I stay on the apex. I don't give myself to anything I think would slide. And then we had a good day. We had just changed our protocol when we were willing to select for skiing that day. And it snows 4 feet overnight. Oh, strike 3. Strike 3 is let's go get a pizza. Or let's go ski the resort, but do not get under anything with objective hazards above us. Any secondary exposure type stuff. So you can just kind of have your own strike methods. And I always say this methodology is not just for avalanches, it's for snow conditions, group dynamics, the equipment, and the weather. So like how far, how steep, how deep are you willing to go based on these other factors too. Stability, you can see. If you pay attention, right? Seth Morrison, he doesn't talk much on the lift. He's just like all business. It's like, gosh, Seth just doesn't talk much, does he? But then you look over and he's just scanning the mountains. He's watching the guy ski under the lift. When he gets off the lift, he's not only like predicted what the snow condition is on how fast you can ski or what you should ski and how you should ski. He's also looking for like, wow, it's super slick today. Wow, the snow looks fast. I better be more careful. Or, wow, I see instability. I see that there's been avalanches in the mountains. But if you really pay attention and you take advantage of every cross-section, at the traverse on the highway, slow down and be like, I don't know, when I'm going to Verbier in Europe, it's like there's all those switchbacks, and you see all the sporty little extreme skiers are just flying up the pass, they don't even think twice. But then you see a really skilled guy from Chamonix, and he just won the world championship, and you're like, why does he stop at every switchback? The guy is doing his research on the way into the hills, up the tram, he's like looking. At Snowbird, I was doing snow safety, and there would be like only five guys scraping the windows at 5 a.m., looking at the route that they're supposed to go bomb in 1 hour. And they get to the top, like, Mongo, I don't think I can do Route 3. I think it's really suspect. And Mongo's like, congratulations, it won't open, and you'll probably be my next snow safety director. You're in charge of Odessa, you know, the rest of the guys are talking about Starbucks and girls, and these five guys are like, these are Alaska guys. I wish I could hire them and bring them to Alaska. The stability you can see, so pay attention to that. The snow conditions on the ground that won't support good snow, you can see and feel. So there's just things you can do to deal. Weather, you can see it, you know, new snow adds weight, wind, increasing temperature and rain. You can take that and start making your forecast. Group dynamics, you absolutely know who's going to push it too much or who doesn't have enough experience, and pick the terrain accordingly. It's still really fun. It doesn't always have to be a big, epic, steep monster to go have fun in the mountains. And then this is a really good way to go. It's just looking at the triangle. The triangle is kind of just an international way of tying it in and tattooing it into your brain. So terrain, we've covered that, concave, convex, unsupported slope, terrain trap, the weather, the four things, warming, rain, wind, and snow, additional snow. And then what was on the ground before. But then the human factor is a biggie, because that's really what it comes down to, right? The human factor is, hey, any concerns, you know? And I'm at Alton, I'm like, yeah, I have concerns. Every roof in the whole village has five cracks on both sides of the roof, and it's been 2 feet overnight. I think there's tension. I see they plowed off four avalanches off the road before we got here. Like, all right, so Dean, you're not wanting to go to Mount Superior today? And I'm like, no. So human factor is a big one. It's the one that gets us the most, because it's my big trip to Alaska, or gosh, it was a horrible snow year the last 3 years. I really want to get after it. Or the patrol's like, not open this all year, and they're about to drop the rope, and 400 people are going to jump down the slope. But be in charge of your own destiny. Don't let the human factor, you know, catch up to you. Wind, visual observations, I can see. I'm sitting in Valdez in the restaurant there at the Best Western, and this is October. This is kind of what it looks like most years, except this year we're only got about 10 feet of snow, but it's only like 1,000 feet on the summits. This year, literally, there's like 20 feet up high already, and it looks like New Zealand because it's all green below. And it's awesome. You can go climb right up to the high alpine and ski huge powder and have a huge base even in October, November. But forecast what you're willing to do. So I'm sitting in the restaurant having my breakfast, and I'm like, what's going on in the mountains to tell me strike one? Look at all that wind smoking off the peaks. All my east and west-facing slopes and south-facing slopes are loading massively. And my snowpack's beginning to get tension in it because the wind does cause tension. So I can just say strike one. And then I've got 22 miles of road I can drive up, and I can observe all kinds of stuff on the way. I can see south-facing, north-facing, east-facing, anything that would tell me strike two or strike three. I'm just looking for it. You know, how about that? The whole range turns to sheen. I forget what year it was, but I flew from Salt Lake to Valdez after guiding a few weeks in Snowbird, and the whole Wasatch Range just cooked. It was like 65 degrees for 4 days, and in the middle of February, everything was just sheen. It was like this table. And I remember the big storm was coming across the Great Salt Lake, and they were predicting massive snow, 10 feet or something crazy. And I was like, oh my gosh, this is just the worst. So many people are going to die this week. And it was 9 people died in 5 days. I mean, it was like, to me, it was so obvious. Like, wow, slick surface in the mountains, and we're going to get all this new snow. People just needed to be patient, you know, and be in charge of their destiny. Oh, look, there's a skin track. Oh, those guys must have made it okay. They're going. That's where I'm going. I'm going up the skin track.
In conditions like that, if it was slick, and then would it ever get stable after that?
No, it can, yeah, absolutely. Snow does have the ability to start bridging over stuff like that or securing to it. Like, even when the street's solid ice, have you ever seen the snow just stick to it finally and actually adhere to it? But the only way to know is by checking that out. And sometimes I say to people, like, why would you ski on my ski track? Let's say we traversed a little slope, 30 degrees, and I traversed it, and it was 2 feet of new snow. You would definitely rather be above my traverse and hammer it as you ski over. I ski over, I give you two pulls up, and you come over, and you're just like, I want some information, because I know the next pitch that we're going to ski is really what we're talking about. This is a nice little test slope for me to check out. So you get 8 feet above my track, and I've now made it unsupported because I left the wall there. And you're trying to see if it's going to crack horizontally. If it cracks horizontally, you're like, whoa. And if it shears off this layer easily, you're like, it's not going to hook up for a couple days, if that. So just little things you can do to check that out. How about that big rock on top of the ridge with all the accumulation from the whole year? You know, focusing on what can happen, you know, fastened snow, like Silverton or going up, even like, you know, when you drive 80 miles from Valdez, that becomes like an intercontinental snowpack, and it's just all facets and sugar and it's like graphite snow. And yet I'm in Valdez skiing 8 miles from town, and it's all stable, it's all good. The clouds roll in. Well, let's move guys over here and we'll go further north. It's like, well, we need to go make a new forecast. We need to go piece that together and make sure that the snow's hooking up. I'll talk more about hasty pits and different techniques on how to check snow as we go tonight. So how does it feel, how does it look, and how does it sound? All of this matters so much because, you know, get out of the car and don't walk out into the meadow that's not been touched. And just see how it supports you at first. There's about 8 feet of snow on the ground. I'm like, wow, it supports me pretty good. I'm consistently only penetrating in a foot. Or all of a sudden you fall up to your armpits. Oh, inconsistencies. Where did this hollow patch come from? But just think about it. If it sounds drummy, it's usually harder snow or softer snow, things like that. Probing down in the snow. I love turning my ski pole upside down and using I tape my handles on so they never come off. And I use my pole a lot just to feel for different layers. And it's like dense, whoa. Dense over nothing is what it felt like. Whoa. But so really pay attention to what you see. Consistency is good, inconsistency is bad. So this is consistency. That track is good penetration of a foot and a half every step for 100 yards. That's rare to get. We get that in these mountains a lot. But when you go to places like Colorado, Utah, Wyoming, places like that, it's rare where you get real consistent snow. You find weak layers. And one thing we get here in Alaska, and it's something we have to pay attention to, is surface ore. Surface ore is wicked. It can be the trigger spot. And it can be a patch here, 10-foot patch, and nowhere else. But you dug all your pits over here and you didn't see it. Or it can be a sun crust. Down the slope, predominantly northwest, and down halfway, the slope goes west. And all of a sudden, you're like, I wonder if there's a sun crust underneath all this new snow. But it can be the trigger point. If there's tension in the snowpack, surface ore, or rotted out area of the faceted snow, or surface ore can just be the trigger spot, and it'll find the next one. It'll find that patch of surface ore or that sun crust over here. It'll go a mile and connect the two. I'll talk about that a little more too, but just think about consistency, and inconsistencies can be your strikes. So, avalanche triangle, and I'm not going to talk about terrain anymore, but I will talk about weather. The only thing that I didn't share with you is something to think about is cold temps, right? So, what does cold temps do to snowpack? It takes big, beautiful crystals that come out of the sky, like the Chugach gets, and they sit on the ground for too many days in a row without storms, and the nights get really, really cold, 20, 30 below, and it takes and just rots on them and turns them into pure sugar, right? So one thing about weather to pay attention to is not just the new snow adds weight, the wind, the increasing temperature and rain, but think about looking back at the temps of what the mountains dealt with a few weeks ago or a few months ago before you went out skiing, and also take into consideration that wet saturation rain layer that now is coming into play more than ever, in mountains that it never used to play. There's saturated rain layers in the snowpack now more than ever. And then snowpack, focus on the surface of the snow. Will the snow adhere to this? Will this snowpack hold it and support it? That sort of thing. Or is the snow just gonna fall through and actually cause that snow to break off and slide? And then the human factor, you just can't talk enough about the human factor. Human factor is really what gets us most of the time. So it's really important that you have everybody engaged. And you know, the way you do that is, I'm at Alpha, not to worry about avalanches. Everyone's in a gold miner, put their boots on, and I like to get a little bit of a head start and meet them at the lift. And I have my transceiver out, and I'm just going, hey, I'm going to check everybody as they go by me. I'm not really, you know, needing to check these guys because we're not even playing them in the backcountry. I just am skiing with guys that I think are smart and great, and they generally always bring safety equipment. I'm just putting us on the page. I'm putting us together. And they're like, oh, wow, Dino's on it. He's checking my transceiver. So then other guys are stepping up to the plate, and then we get to the top, and they're like, yeah, that's smart. I should make sure everyone's boots aren't iced up when we get to the top of the ridge. And then all of a sudden, Jim's over there going, hey, Dean, your boot has a lot of ice on it. Well, thanks, Jim. We've kind of just kind of created a protocol of watching out for one another. Just the human factor, it's so easy just to ignore the little rules. And the rules are important, right? Have the right gear, have a good group of people, check your gear. Make sure everything's working properly. It's the little dominoes that lead up to the big ones. So terrain, slope angle, slope aspect, and anchor's configuration. What slopes slide the most, guys? What aspect? South, or south, east, west, or north?
It depends where you are.
Not in South America. We're in North America.
I'd say around here, a lot of our winds are coming from the east, so stuff on the west side gets loaded up.
Yeah, but even before wind, think about something that happens every single day. And
sun.
Yeah, there you go. So what aspects go through, get hammered by the sun the most?
South
and east, exactly. So I brought gifts for people that have awesome answers. There you go. and the reason for this, guys, is because they go through such a broad temperature gradient, right? They go through really cold nights, really cold days. Why do all the goats and sheep hang out on southeast-facing slopes? And why do all the brown bears wake up in April and hike up and traverse south and east-facing slopes? They go up because there's so many dead goats, and that's their first meal. It took me years to figure out why they did that and what the heck they were doing. I see these big brownies way up there, even climbing up couloirs and going up and over ridges. I'm like, if I woke up at 3,000 feet at the top of the bush line, why would I go higher if I was a bear? And that's what they do. They look for dead goats, and there's hundreds of them.
Do you think that there's been an increase because of warming trends the last, since 77 or so?
With
avalanches and goats getting gotten avalanches. We're wildlife biologists, we get asked these wildlife.
Yeah, I do. I think a lot more goats are getting wiped out because the north region of Valdez, the last time I hunted it, they didn't open it this year, but the last time I hunted it 3 years ago, I got my goat. I went up there, divvied out, finally got him. It was so hard. And on my way down, I looked on the ridge opposing me. And I was like, look at all those goats. And I started counting them. I counted 60 goats on this one ridge. I don't know if you know the mountain hogback in Valdez. It's a really insane climb to get up there, to finally get up there. It's so hard. It takes like all day just to get there and then find a goat and other things. So it took me 2 days to find a nice billy. And on my way down, I was like, stopped to rest. And I'm like, wow. And now there's hardly any goats on that mountain. And I think that the rain last year caused so many wet slides. I think the snow was so frozen everywhere else, it was hard for them to dig down to food. So
icy conditions.
They were forced more onto the south facings and east facings more than ever. But yeah, and it truly is causing making it more difficult to forecast snowpack. And you're seeing a lot more tricky conditions out there. But, you know, it doesn't mean that north facing, northeast, northwest is an end all and it's perfectly safe. Absolutely, that's not the case. But what's nice about it is I call it the blue snow theory. And the way I can tell if I'm in the mountains and I'm skiing on north, northeast, northwest, east, northeast, is I have this blue tint to it. It's not getting direct light. It's even if it's getting sunlight, it's not really white. It has a little bit of a blue to it. But then what I'm really looking for is I'm looking for snow that's white. And I'm like, at 10 a.m. in the morning, I can start seeing all my east and northeast aspects. And then know what's dead north and what's not. And the reason that north is nice is because it's generally better conditions, better quality. It's easier to forecast and easier to predict. And it generally is just a more stable snowpack. But you know, of course, north-facing slopes can get you, but if you go with the rule of thumb that, oh, they're all the same, that's not the case. Your east and your south are just really suspect, a lot more than anything else. So the beauty is, don't get tricked by it. At 2 p.m., you're starting to see your west-northwest aspect, right, getting lit. You know, really amazing skiers look at the terrain. So much of this is about performance skiing, too. Like, you look down the mountain, and a really great skier's like, the film crew's like, oh, it's lit, the sun's coming onto it, time to ski. Oh, hold on, a cloud's going by, and you're sitting there waiting forever. And then all of a sudden, you're like, it's fully lit, and it's just got that blue tint to it. It's got that super soft, beautiful light that film crews like. But down on the left bottom part of the slope, it's a fully lit white slope. And you're like, aha, predominantly west, northwest facing slope. And when I get halfway down, I might run into the most wicked sun crust ever and rip my skis or my legs off. Or there could be a lot of new snow on top of the sun crust. So just looking at aspect and reading aspect is so key. Without running around with a compass, so to speak, you can use the blue snow theory to identify.
Yeah, I understand the south aspect thing, but are you saying that southeast is worse than southwest? And I don't understand.
No, I'm just saying east and south are the
why, two. Why east worse than west? Seems like west would get the warmer sun later in the day, and east would be cooler.
It starts playing later in April.
Uh-huh.
West doesn't get as much time in the sun.
Uh-huh.
East wakes right up to it, right?
Uh-huh.
As soon as the sun rises, bam.
Okay.
It's getting touched by the sun till noon,
uh-huh,
or more sometimes. And then, of course, your south is getting it,
yeah,
all,
yeah,
day long.
Uh-huh.
And then your west come into play, but they're not nearly as suspect. And it's definitely more of a May thing, where your west starts playing.
Uh-huh.
Think about these, I always say, come April 15th or April 20th, our train gets cut in half. Because we're not willing to just be south, east, and even west a lot of the time.
Uh-huh. Okay, that was cool.
Yeah. So, slope aspect matters, but so slope angle matters too, right? And they teach this a lot. They always say, like, oh, just lower the angle of your slope. That's not totally the case. When it comes to sun crust and surface order, you can see 20 degree slopes sliding. Those slides I showed earlier, those are really low angle slopes. Those are big slides. The problem with, like, what is the perfect slope that people talk about mostly in avalanche, in the avalanche world, slide most
32
off?
Degrees.
Yeah, 32 to 48, 45. It depends where you're at in the world. It changes everywhere, by the way. It depends where you're at. But you guys, it's not totally true. You can't just say that, oh, we have avalanches and we're seeing tons of them. Let's just go ski low angle terrain and we won't have any problems. If you have sun crust or surface or in tension, you could see some action. I mean, it's not going to move as fast. It's not going to slide with the same velocity. But just add a train trap in it or a cliff band or some trees to get snagged into, and all of a sudden you have trauma and everything else. I will say this, you can't just go ski steep terrain because it's more stable. The general rule of thumb, steeper terrain cleans itself during storms and slides more often, and it generally isn't holding as much weight as your 35, 40 degree slopes. You know, in Canada, they have these big, massive avalanches, right? They kind of like to push people through the mountains until they ski people like 9 at a time down the slope. And it's honestly just kind of ignoring backcountry protocol, and it's more of a moneymaker. But they have really amazing snow science too, so they dig really amazing pits and they get a really good baseline and they're pretty good at forecasting too. But when it occurs, it's a climax and it's a big monster slide, 8-foot crown, 400 feet across, 200 yards across. What do you do with that? I mean, that's just trauma. It's just asphyxiation type stuff. It doesn't matter if you got an airbag or anything else. It's so big. By the time you even get caught up at the bottom, you're so asphyxiated by all the snow in your lungs. Or you've been beat up so bad by the chunks and blocks and tumbled so hard or hit rocks and trees. But here's this. I'm not going to say you need to go ski Mount Francis to be safe. That's absolutely not the case. Because steep slopes, there's more likely to fall, tumble, have a slide for life. But how about this? We're on a strike one day. We ski this nice chute, more of that micro-type terrain. We ski the chute. It has tons of safe zones, good places where we can check out and regroup and talk. And then we get to the apron. And then at the apron, where do we go? It's 1,000 feet to the bottom of the valley, It's just a massive apron with no features like safe zones or trees or rocks or anything to regroup at. And you're like, wow. We kind of had some cracking above and it was woofing a little bit. We were starting to notice. And you get to the apron, you're like, gosh, where do we go from here, Jim? And it's like, you know what? Take a look around the corner, Harry, and tell me what you think of that. And you're like, aha, 50 degree slope. It's only 300 feet tall. And then you can see this often, most oftentimes, you'll look at it like, wow, it's sloughed the whole storm. And you'll see slough piles and stuff. And you'll see that it's not holding the whole storm or all that snow or the whole season's snow. Or you'll see that it even slid a couple times during the storm or throughout the year. And it doesn't mean you go rip the thing, but it might be the perfect little way to traverse out of Dodge to get to a safer place or to side slip and to avoid that big apron. So, you know, think about what could happen with how that works with steeper terrain. I mean, this is a pretty good example. That's 70 degrees up there on an unsupported slope. And, of course, there's some good anchoring in the rocks and stuff that you get just so jagged and so cool that way. But how in the world is snow stick to something so steep? The reason it does is because the only thing that sticks to it is the snow that actually was really high quality that would stick to it. And everything that wasn't really high quality, that had no ability to adhere to it, just fell off the mountain. But these 30, 40 degree slopes, they hold it all. And when it happens, it's big.
So are people skiing this side?
What's that?
Are people skiing this slope?
Yeah, actually people have skied. I did the first ascent a couple years ago. It took me 22 years to get it, and it was more of a personal thing. But
but is it not a lead? It's a lead
this
slope?
This is north. Right here, this has the slightest west to it. What I'm talking about is that blue snow shows you. This is like 10 o'clock at night in April. But I can just tell you this. Where's there going to be a sun crust underneath this slope? It's going to be over here on this west-facing aspect, even southwest even over here, right? But yeah, the reason it's pretty nice is you have all this anchoring and all this jagged stuff holding the snow. And I have this north to cause a more consistent snowpack. So
it looks like it's on the lee side because the cornice is coming this way. So is it not a lee slope on the lee side?
It depends. The wind can blow any direction in the mountains. 80% of the time, though, the wind's coming from the Chugach, from Thompson Pass, and it's blowing southwest. And that's why it developed this cornice right here. What I'm trying to get at is just talking about aspect. When you come up to a slope, say to yourself, wow, we've had a really warm winter. And I'm looking down a south-facing slope, so what happened to the snowpack on the south-facing slope? Snow that goes through really broad temperature gradients causes your worst metamorphosis within the snowpack to break down the structure of the snow, right? If the snow is falling in Cordoba, and this is perfect, like 36 degrees, and these big, huge, beautiful flakes are landing. I can't even catch them in my mouth because they're so big. There's already like 100 snowflakes that are sticking together in the sky before they even hit the ground. That's good snow. It's got fingers and branches, and it's starting to lock together and hold. How about stuff that falls out of the sky that looks like pins and needles? I mean, if you grab snow and it's 30 degrees below freezing, and you grab the snow, and it won't even make a snowball, like, huh, this isn't that good of snow for the next storm to sit on top of it. You can grab really beautiful snow under, well under 30 degrees, and it's perfect powder. It's not wet snow. It's not warmed up snow, but yet it adheres. And you're like, snowball fight time, opposed to the alternative. So just think about what happens in the snowpack. How about this? When you leave the ice cream on the counter overnight and forget to put it back in the freezer, you wake up at 6 in the morning, you go to work, you're like, I left it out, darn it. I'll put it back in the fridge, no one will notice. Well, of course, you pull it out and it's lost all its consistency. It's like soup. It's got none of those fingers and branches holding. It's all turned to rounds. It's all turned to just rounded crystals. So that's what happens on slopes that go through a broader temperature gradient. It goes through really cold nights and really warm days. It's much more suspect, and you'll see a lot more action. And the two things that cause tension, which tension is what causes propagation, is wind and temperature gradient. Warm temps and wind causes tension more than ever before. People don't talk about tension much. It's amazing to me that they don't. Because at the end of the day, does it really matter how weak the layers are in the snowpack if you can't propagate an avalanche? That's not true. And I'll show you some stuff about things to look for tension a little bit more. But anchors and configuration is a really important one. That's why I love mounts like the San Juans or the Chigach. Is they're so young and there's so much jaggedness and the snow adheres so beautifully. Don't be shy to realize what's an erosion process in the summertime and avoid it like the plague. Like, if you have an area in the mountains where it's always eroding rocks and there's always mudslides and all this stuff, if it's near a populated ski destination, it already owns a bunch of people's names that have been killed in there. It's a place that slides often and is super suspect and is unpredictable. And when you get these super grassy slopes, or when you get these really eroded little stream areas and things like that, snow has a hard time hanging in there too. It's just always changing in there more than ever, and you start getting a weaker snowpack around those. So don't be shy to identify the places that you like to hike or snow machine or recreate, and pay attention to, like, wow, honey, this thing always has a mudslide. It always has rocks falls all the time. And it will not hold snow great. And that's just a good start to start out before the season to say, here's areas I will not ski or recreate in once we get snow on it. So anchors and configuration are great. How about places that don't? You know, grassy slopes, overgrazed slopes. I mean, this is what you see a lot in Wyoming and New Mexico and Colorado. There's a lot of these grassy slopes that have just been grazed for 100 plus years. They're smooth as can be, and yet you'll just see people skiing them all the time. But then you'll read about it later, you know. What's that one entire, the right side attempt or two, there's this really neat run. I never would ski it because I knew it was just the smoothest grassy slope ever. And Sam once had such horrible snowpack. Everyone does it. All you guys love to ski that thing, and they get into this big couloir, and you leave the biggest, most unsupported slope, rotten slope above you for another 2,000 feet. But configuration is key. So trees, stumps, rocks, that's great. And that's what I was talking about on a strike 2 day or a strike 3 day if I'm avoiding concave convex. I'd rather go ski in the trees where it's got this anchoring and the trees are holding up. And I can tell that the trees don't slide because the trees still have branches facing uphill. And it just is the perfect situation. There's anchoring, there's good aspect. How about this? Vegetation provides anchors and clues. This is Mount Baldy at Snowbird. This is the first slide I showed you in the presentation. And that avalanche occurred right here, in that one concave. So everyone hikes up to here, and then they traverse across. Well, obviously, why are these trees hating life? I mean, the reason they're hating life is because they always get hit by avalanches. They're in the starting zone of avalanches. And when this thing gets filled in 5, 10, 8 feet, and you get a big avalanche pulls out up in here, all these trees just get ripped out or bent over. And they survive pretty good when they're small and spindly and they just lay over like bungees, but they get a little bit bigger and then just break off. And that's why the trees have never been able to take hold on the side of this mountain. So I can look at it and say to myself, wow, this is a slope that slides often. And I have a choice though, it's pretty nice, because if you pick a good line, a good route, then you pick one that gives you a bailout too. Which means I don't have to commit to Mount Baldy. You know, these trees right here are big and beautiful for a reason. They haven't been taking on all these avalanches over the years. They don't slide much, if at all. I can get to here and go, what do you think, guys? And everyone looks across like, well, looks like the wind was up the slope. It looks like it took most of the snow over. So on this given day, I'd probably traverse right across it. But if I got up there and I didn't have these wind stripes showing me that the wind had stripped this mountain right and loaded it on this other side, I would definitely be suspect. And I would say, guys, let's just ski the glades. Let's ski the nice tree run. Let's ski where the branches are still up, facing uphill on the trees. And in some places like California or some places in France, there are no branches 20 feet. So you're looking for trees that are smoothed off on the backside, on the uphill side of the tree, or have scars from avalanches that have hit, you know, stumps or rocks that hit the side of the tree. You can identify stuff and look for clues and look for places to slide or don't slide. This is a big one. This is no joke. Convex is serious. And this is about a 12-foot crown, this avalanche here. And this is big. And this is an avalanche that we triggered years ago with our heli-ski company. And this was a really good lesson. And I'll tell you what we did wrong. We got some new snow. It wasn't that much new snow, like 2 feet of new snow in the mountains. And just before that storm, we had quite a bit of moisture in the air, right? And we all, you guys know what surface ore is? Surface ore is when you have freezing fog or when you have moisture getting sucked out of the snow and the air is really cold and it causes these feathers to grow on the surface. And you can just say we just stacked dominoes across the whole slope and all this polar bear hair is sitting up. And now all this new snow falls on this polar bear hair. And now we've put it up to 40 degrees and all of a sudden these little dominoes fall over. And it causes avalanches. It's really, really difficult to forecast because Jack Frost flies through the mountains and puts a little bit here, none here. And then he puts a little bit more here. But here's what happens. If you have surface ore in one place, let's say we have this whole patch is here, it's 20 feet by 20 feet, and we've had some wind or we've had some temperature gradients, and there's no surface ore all the way over for 100 yards, and then all of a sudden 100 yards away there's another patch of surface ore. This can trigger, this can be the trigger spot that can cause the propagation to connect the dots. And this happens with sun crust and surface ore. And that's why I'm saying 20 to even 30 degree slope should be a concern of yours when it comes down to surface ore or sun crust. Because it all just comes down to tension and all the snow sitting on dominoes waiting for somebody to kick one over. But that's what happened here. So I fly in, I'm leading out on this given day. I fly in, I dig a snow pit here, I dig a snow pit here, I dig a snow pit here, and I dug a snow pit right there. And here's what we did wrong. I absolutely was staying to the apex, right? I'm staying up on the hip. I want to stay on the ridge. I didn't even like it. See how I took my people around here, got them back on the ridge system? I didn't want to be on anything that didn't give something the ability to slide away from me. And I didn't find anything of concern. So I went up, I flew up again, and I skied down, and I started stacking tracks a little bit to the right. I had made two runs. Other guys were coming into the area. What do you think of the snow, Dean? Oh, it's pretty good. How were your snow pits? I started calling out all the scientific information on how the snow looked in my snow pits and all this. Sounds good to me, sounds good to me. But here's the deal. I had new snow, strike one. I knew that there was some moisture in the air a week before that, strike two. We didn't belong getting out onto or farming out on a slope. Here's what we did wrong. On a day that we had concerns, we developed confidence. A day is not long enough to develop confidence in the mountains. It's like, let's let the cycle play its course and let's kind of pay attention. And we could have skied big, beautiful, long apex ridge hips for a week straight and not had to get on a slope like this. The 80th skier triggered this pocket. So four or five other groups came in. I did two runs. Other groups did three runs. We all run around with groups of five. The 80th skier triggered this little pocket. It was really small. It was only like a foot deep, and it was only like 30 feet by 30 feet. But 30 feet by 30 feet and a foot deep is actually pretty heavy, maybe 5,000 pounds, 10,000 pounds. And it was enough weight to trigger this much bigger one. And this guy, this was the second skier in this group. He didn't get hurt, luckily. I mean, when I flew in to assist, it looked like the world had fallen apart. This is a big slide. That's a person right there. I flew in, I landed like right here. Oops. I landed right here and got out with my transceiver thinking I was gonna have to do a major ordeal. And I skied down and he's laughing. He's like, oh, I'm fine, I just had snow on my tummy. You know, but look at how bad that could have been. I mean, there's one good thing about the slope is a dissipation slope, so the avalanche was able to travel out and dissipate. It was just a really good lesson. And this is where strike three methodology came from. On this day, it was just time to go, okay, we need to have some ways of saying go and no go and what we're going to select on a given day. And that's what we did on that day.
Oops.
I gotta exit, huh? Yeah. I'm not gonna mess with it. This is kind of cool because I love slopes like this because it gives me the ability to assess. And so I always say, I always say this to the guides and to my partners, never pass up a high point to scope out your line. You know, great skiers do this, or great snow machiners, or great mountaineers. They take their route to the high point to relook at things. or they'll even climb mountains that way, and they'll get a high point or a cross section. But that's the beauty of something like this, because I don't have to give myself to it. So I picked a route that's like, okay, I get a place to take another look, to make another decision if I should do this or not. You have to look at the snowpack and go, should I do this run or not? And this run's pretty neat because I could get right here, I could ski down, and personally, I would just ski down right here or take my snow machine, and I would just be like, and I probably would send that avalanche. I mean, so a lot of times, if you challenge slopes or you make some noise on it, you can get five people on the ridge, pack the snow on your feet, guys. One, two, three, and you can feel that. You can send so much energy through the snow, it's amazing. If that didn't work, then I'm going to get over here and take a look and dig a snow pit. And whatever it might be, it could be a gut instinct, like, I don't know what it is about this slope, I just don't like it. It gives me the chance to go, I'm bailing out. I'm going to just sidestep up 20 feet, I'm going to traverse over and get on the ridge where the photo was taken. And all of a sudden I get to ski a nice, big, long ridge, and I still get to have some fun in the mountains, but I didn't give myself something that weighs 250,000 tons that would take off like that. There's no like, oh, time to put the bugle in my mouth, time to pull the airbag. It's not like that. It's just like the rug just gets swept. Let's say I decided I like this slope. I love thinking this way. Why would I just ski the gut of this thing if I could ski it diagonally? I go up here, I dug a pit up here, I did some hasty pits, I skied, I came in here and put some weight to it, maybe had five of us jump on it. Maybe I locked my brakes up on top of it just to challenge it. And then I get here, I dig a pit, I'm like, oh, wow, there's that shiny sun crust layer, or there's that surface ore underneath the snow. And then if I do some nice tests and try to identify tension, I'll be like, oh, wait, time not to do this. Or let's say I decide that I like it. I get up here and I go, wow, trauma. I probably come over here and see this thing going right to left and not give myself to the whole slope. So even when I trust the snow, it's nice to have little rules like that. My son's 12 years old, and he just automatically does it. It's the coolest thing. Even a couple years ago, I was like, hey, Wyatt, don't worry. You can come straight at me. And he just ignored my direction, and he diagonaled the slope. I was so proud of him. I was like, I should have never said come right at me. I should just let him read the mountains the way he reads the mountains. And I said, oh, you heard me, right? He's like, yeah, I heard you, Dad. I just felt more comfortable diagonaling the slope left toward the apex instead of staying on the double fall line to the right. Because if it slid, the snow goes double fall line right. He's absolutely right. He just diagonaled the slope. It was really neat. So concave, these are the worst. This is about a 30-foot crown to give you an idea how big this fracture is. That cornice was like 80 feet tall. I guided for 30 days straight. It was the most stable snowpack I've ever seen. The snow was such high quality. I mean, it was like perfect powder for a month straight in Valdez. You couldn't even walk. You get done guiding and you had cramps so bad in your legs, you were just like, come on, we need a weather day. And you never say that in Valdez or Cordova. I fly around the corner and this big monster occurred. I was like, where did this come from? I haven't seen anything in 4,000 square miles for a month. And this thing is a massive avalanche. But here's the deal. Cornices can trigger avalanches even when a 50-pound bag of fertilizer explosives can't. They have so much weight and they impact the slope so hard, that's what caused this avalanche. So strike one is a massive cornice. It's like petting Michael Tyson's tiger. Why would I even dare pet some guy, crazy guy's tiger, let alone go stand on a cornice or go ski below one? So it's in a concave. It's just like strike one, strike two, strike three. Where do you go in a place like this if something happens? There's nowhere to go. And it's just so much weight, so much energy, and so much power. You just don't stand a chance. We'll talk about the next one that's a real big concern, is unsupported slopes. And this was classic. This was my track here with five, four clients. And we had new snow. We had about 3 feet of new snow. And I didn't know if there was surface ore or not. I wasn't sure what had happened. We're about 20 miles into the mountains. We had tons of snow pit data from the whole season, so I was kind of going off of snow pit data and this and that. But I knew this. I'm like, 4 feet of new snow. Guys, why don't you hang right here? It's So I'm kind of going high point to high point to high point. In this case, I'm relying on mechanized equipment because I'm like, guys, I got right here and I dug a pit, and I got right here and dug another one. I got here and I found surface ore on a sun crust. And I'm like, wow, surface ore on a sun crust above an unsupported slope. I was so uncomfortable, I didn't want to try to hike back up to these guys because I didn't want to like impact the slopes. I came here, jumped over here, I got on this apex, skied down, got the heli, and had my guys picked up. You know, and that's what I did. I was like, right before I went to check out the slope, hey guys, I'm going to put you right here. Here's the flag. The heli's going to land here. If I don't like what I see, we're going to fly up and come get you. So if, I hollered to them, hey guys, strap your skis. it was one of those. 4 days later, I flew by the same spot, and another company had followed our track, so to speak, and they skied through there. And he was probably doing exactly what I was doing. I had some pretty good skiers. I wasn't probably in a position to go ski big, steep stuff with them because I was worried about the new snow. And so I'm trying to do something kind of a mini golf, fun, steep kind of terrain. And I got it handed to me. I'm like, no way am I bringing these guys through this unsupported slope. And this guy, whoever the guy was, I still don't know who it was to this day, did pretty much what I thought I was going to do. And on his fourth skier, the Avalanche got nailed. You can see all the tracks, 1, 2, 3, 4. So it was one of his latter skiers that skied this and took the ride. And we didn't hear anything about it, so probably didn't get hurt or buried. But, you know, it's one of those things. And what's going on here is unsupported slope. And with snowpack as deep as the Chugach, this cliff could go across the slope even, right? So we didn't even take that into consideration. But here's the deal. Blue snow theory, it's got some wet. It's actually west-northwest. So I got a north to it. I got more consistent snow, generally more stable, generally better quality. And what's going on? We have 80 feet of snow in the mountains this year. Why is there no snow over here? Dead south. This is where the goats love to hang out, right? So this is all just sun crust, super slippery, and soft, faceted sugar snow. And if you add new snow to it, of course, that slides all the time. It's not because it just melts all the time, too. It slides, melts, and falls off. But it goes from like a west-northwest, and just add a little bit of blue to it. That's got the tiniest bit of north to it. You wrap around west, southwest, dead south. So I had new snow on top of a surface ore with a sun crust. And of course, that's what you're gonna get. This is a huge fracture. This is about 30 feet deep. This slide is about a quarter mile across. These guys are about half a mile in front of the deposition, so this photo doesn't really give it justice. This is a massive avalanche, and the debris is like 300 feet deep. It buried like a whole little canyon up next to the glacier. And the deal with it is it's east-facing, so it's definitely got lots of sun crust and facets. And this cliff was buried. And this cliff would have looked something like that. See that little lumpy, bumpy stuff? And that's how you can identify it from above or from below and say, huh, something about the slope looks inconsistent in the middle. There might be a cliff buried in the middle. But that's what it was. It was tension, of course, with new snow on a sun crust, and it was unsupported. So strike one, strike two, strike three, no one would belong on that slope or under it. This guy gets out of the car, and it's blown 100 miles an hour. He's like, there's no snow available for an avalanche. Where would have he should have hiked? He hiked up out of the car, got to about right here. This is a tiny avalanche. I think the deepest part of the fracture line was a foot and a half. But it's a terrain trap. Terrain traps allow it to stack up on you, and all of a sudden, what doesn't seem like a very big slide, big heavy mass on top of you, he didn't live for a minute. And there was no saving this guy. Where could he hike and been safe? And to forecast snow, and to look at snow, and to be in a better vantage point to see more, up this ridge, you know. And if he likes the snow, then he could maybe ride through here and ride the half pipe, so to speak, but at least he'd get a lot more information. I mean, if I stood right here and probably gave that a kick, I probably could have kicked that, you know. But yeah, it's super sad. Everyone's trying to save this guy, and there was really nothing to save. That's why you don't get confidence from your certifications and your safety equipment. You really think about where you should be in the mountains. You're either in the right place or the wrong place. And look around and make sure you're in the right place. So weather, precipitation, temperature, and wind spell avalanche. precipitation in the form of rain, I just wanted, that's why I put the slide in here. Really start paying attention to saturated snow underneath new snow. It's a big one these days. People are having a lot more action in places like California, Washington, British Columbia, Alaska with that. It's a big deal. Even in interior Canada, I started to see a lot more rain in the middle of the winter. Like even places that used to be really cold, you know, in the, like the Blue River, places like that. Like he was telling me about how they're getting a little more humbled by that too. Or our lower elevations around Cordova and Valdez, you know, Valdez slopes that never would have rain at 5,000 feet that aren't near glaciers, where we have glaciation effect, usually always snows, but where we don't have a lot of glaciers, we're seeing more rain up to 5,000 feet than we've ever seen. And so we get such big dumps, it could snow 8 feet in a couple of days, all of a sudden I got a really wet, saturated layer of 8 feet of new snow. That's what this one's all about. Wind is a big one too, guys. And wind can hide itself, right? So wind can be blowing in the mountains, and new snow can cover up all the clues. So you got to pay attention to the clues that are under the snow too, and I'll show you that in a second. And then temperature, I just can't say it enough. If you're skiing in Valdez and it's generally 38 degrees in the wintertime, and then you drive up 100 miles to the north, it's generally 30 below up there in the wintertime. And it's just a whole other world. So it just takes look back at the weather pattern to see what was going on with wind and temps and rain. So most avalanches occur during, immediately after storms. What do you need to do? You need to let it settle and adhere. A lot of good ways to do that is let the snow add the weight. It's good if it's kind of nice in the Chugach Trench because we get so much snow that if there's weak layers, a lot of times it cleans it out. And that's why we get pretty stable snowpack. But you don't want to be out there in it or living under it when it's doing this, right? So it's important to let it do its thing, but don't put yourself out there. Let the mountains clean themselves and be patient to let them clean themselves and then start taking a look at the mountains and seeing if you want to go in them. So let the snowpack do its thing. It takes time to bond. And so let's say, note all these beautiful crystals, like the ones we love, that bond together before they even hit the ground. And we got 8 feet of it. And it landed on a lot of different layers. It landed on a sun crust on your south and east facing slopes. It landed on a really wind buff layer on everything else in the mountains. How can you tell if it's settled, if it is settling? Well, a lot of times you just walk right through it, or you ski right through it. Yesterday it was this deep, and the next day it's this deep. I'm physically seeing it settling. All right, this is nice. It's settling. It's starting to adhere. It's starting, you know. And I just want to be out there skiing in places where I'm not putting myself at risk when I'm skiing stuff that can't slide, like trees that are tight and they don't slide much, if at all. Or I'm just hiking out past the parking lot and I'm just walking through it. And yesterday it was up to here, and the next day it's up to here. Or dig snow pits and measure it, right? Measure it. Or you can just look at a big mushroom rock with all the years accumulation on it, and there's the event from the last few days. And you're like, wow, it settled out a lot. I mean, 2 days ago it looked like 5 feet, and now it looks like 3 feet. And there's also physical ways. You can see it visually, too, by just looking at it this way. See how it's coning around the trees? Trees, fence posts, and signposts will send a nice little shadow around that thing. And that little area won't get as much warming or as much radiation as other places, and you'll get that coning. And this is stuff you can see driving down the road at 20 miles an hour going, oh, it's been settling. Look at all the cones around the trees. And then I want to go and walk in it or ski in it and get a feel for it. But let it settle. Let it bond to the layer below. How do we find out if it bonded to the layer below? There's a lot of ways to do it. A lot of people just go skiing because that's what we do. We're skiers. So what can we do to deal with that? One could just be like, you know, get to the top of the ridge. There's this nice little 10-foot patch of snow hanging over a little 5-foot cliff. It's 40 degrees. Give it a kick. See if it's holding. All of a sudden it slides off. You're like, wow, it's not adhering to the old layer at all. Or I traverse across a small slope and we're skiing an Alta or something, and you ski 8 feet or 10 feet above my track. And you're looking to see if it's breaking, sliding off, and all that snow's breaking off of the old snow below. And what you're really looking for is cracking, fracturing. If you get horizontal cracking and fracturing, it's like huge red flag. If you get vertical cracking, you're seeing the cracks shooting down the slope, it's beginning to get tension. But if you see it going horizontally, man, you can propagate. I mean, what is it, 5,000 feet per second is what a fracture line travels? That's just like a couple miles, right? That tourniquet arm side was a big deal. What, it traveled like 3 miles and it was like some places 50 feet deep when all the snow machiners got killed. But just think about, a lot of people don't. They're like, oh, I can just ski this little thing. And it's not little because it's 100 feet of snow, and if there's tension, all of a sudden you've got a monster. So let the snow settle. Let it adhere to the layers below. Other ways to check it is just dig down. A lot of times I don't need a shovel or anything else. I can just take over into the snow, dig down. I like to do this. I grab my ski pole, and I stick it in as deep as it'll go, and I'll cut a plug. In a chugach snow, generally you pull out a big plug, and it looks like a cylinder. And I lay it on my arm horizontally, so all the layers are like this, and I burp it. I just let the weight tell me if there's weak layers. And all of a sudden, it cracks clean in half. I'm like, oh, there's a weak layer right there. I'm just getting a little bit of information. I throw it down the slope, the challenge slope below me. When I come in, I just use my hands and gloves. I dig down 2 or 3 feet, 3 or maybe even 4 feet. On a 30-degree slope, it takes nothing to dig down 3 or 4 feet. And then I got this nice clean face. Here's this nice face. And I'm like kind of looking at the layers. And then I take my ski pole and I use it as like a saw. I saw it here. I saw it here. And I grab it. I put my hands in like about 1.5 to 2 feet. And I pull on it. And if I pull on it and I get some shear, and yeah, shear is this where if it breaks off perfectly clean and with energy, like it slides really quick, I'm like, oh, that's a weak layer. And then I'm like, red flag. And now I'm like, okay, tension. Is there tension in these in this snowpack? So I do my shear, I do my little test. And if I do this right, what I like to do is I traverse in. This slope is untouched where you guys are sitting. It's just beautiful snow. If I came in and I, with my skis, I just dig this out as much as I can. You can do this with a snow machine. You can do this with your legs. I just undermined this whole little thing. I left like an unsupported wall. I call this the corner test. I just grab both my ski poles. I've cut all this out and done my little hasty pits. And I stick it in this corner of snow. And I yard on it. And if I get horizontal cracking from that, I'm like, wow, tension or weak layer, and I have tension. And then, you know, nothing else. You dig your pit. You say, hey, Jim, come on down and stand above my hole. And jump on it. No, jumps on it twice. And it slides off and sends cracks horizontally on the slope. And you're just like, let's go get a pizza. Just little rules, little things you can do to test the snow. So wind is something you can see, right? You can just see the wind blowing and ripping off the peaks. What if it snowed and you couldn't see these wind striations and things like this? All of a sudden it was covered. This, let's say this doesn't exist and this is a race under review. And all we have is, did it blow during the 4-day storm? Well, it blew on the last day of the storm on this one, obviously. But little clues to find out if wind was involved with the storm would be looking for things like cornice building, which would be like this. See how the cornices were breaking off and the chunks were falling? That's when you can see the wind had played a role and was building, actively building cornices. You'll see little pockets that have pulled out. You'll see chunks down there. Sometimes you don't see much except you see the chunks buried in a foot of snow. And you're like, huh, a lot of cornices were dropping off chunks. I wonder why. Well, it's because it was actively building cornices because the wind was smoking. Sloughing, see the sloughing down here? That's because the wind is blowing and taking the snow off this little plateau, and it just goes over the edge, and it creates that hydraulic, right, that comes over the edge and creates that wind doing this action. How does snow adhere to a cornice, right? It's just that wind, and it takes the snow, and it warms it up and causes it to get almost like glue, and it comes in, lands, and just falls onto the slope below. It could be 6 feet of new snow. It only snowed 1.5 feet, or you didn't have that much snow. How about this? I was up here 2 weeks before, and I show up 2 weeks later, and I skin up on top of this little ridge, and whoa, there was hardly any cornices up on this ridge. And I just know the wind has been blowing for 3 weeks up on this ridge. I just have to wonder how much snow is on the side of this mountain. A lot. See how snow's moving and creeping and pulling the trees down with it? It says to me that that thing is ready for a climax slide. It's something I want to avoid like the plague. But cornices are really good ways to see if what the wind's been doing or how much it's been blowing, how much slopes are loaded and that sort of thing. So cornices, like I was saying, like my friend in New Mexico owns wolves and he's way into them and they're really beautiful and they're cool animals. But he always wants me to get in the pen. And I'm like, no way, Lane, I'm not getting in the pen with these wolves. And he's like, why? I go, they're unpredictable animals. They deserve the respect. I don't need to be in their enclosure. No thanks. And that's how cornices are. Cornices are like a wild animal. You can raise a hippo, and on the eighth year, he kills you. It's just because he's a wild animal. It's just his thing. He's unpredictable. He's supposed to be wild. Cornices are wild and unpredictable. And it's anyone's guess when they're going to break off. It's just weight versus angle. A lot of people are like, oh, don't worry about the cornice. It's not warm today. Or, oh, cornices really crack, and the crystals start breaking when you get really cold temperatures. No, I mean, they can fall in 3 seconds or in 3 months. It's just, the deal is this. They don't just roll over you and crush you, or they don't just fall off the mountain with you on top of them. They can hit a slope and impact it with so much weight, they can find layers that nothing else can. I mean, I've done explosive work, I've done all these things, and nothing was triggered. And then all of a sudden, a cornice, a good-sized cornice hits the slope and sends out like a 30-foot avalanche. And you're like, wow. So, think about when you're on a ridge, a lot of times it's hard to tell if you're on Mother Earth or you're out on the sky. Connect the dots, go tree to tree, rock to rock, and then you know you're on the mountain. Just because there's a trail, it doesn't mean it's a perfect trail. I mean, as a patroller at Snowbird, I've definitely come back on my route and came back and looked at the ridge that I hiked up at 5 a.m. I'm like, whoa, that was a pretty bad trail I left behind. Not always is the trail correct. Try to pay attention to where the mountain really is, because cornices and ridges can build so much out there. And this is that one place that I showed you earlier that had the big avalanche here. This was just, who knows which cornice fell off. I think this one came off first, and it propagated this lightning bolt fracture down and caused it to go up here and undermine this cornice too. But it's just like, concave, unsupported, and a cornice. It's like, I do not belong here. And I only say this too, the guys, that crevasses are unsupported slopes too. Because picture the snowpack getting really cold temperatures coming up from below and rotting out the snowpack and causing that metamorphosis to break down those crystals. So crevasses are unsupported slopes too. And increasing temperature, rain. This is pretty obvious stuff. These are steamrollers, right? This is a southeast-facing slope in late April. But this day was below freezing. It was the radiation of those dark rocks sending off the warmer temps to warm the surface of the snow, taking consolidated snow and turning unconsolidated. And there's a lot more that's going on nowadays than I've ever seen. Like, even like the back of big dark green lodges, I'm seeing at ski resorts, wet slides off the back of the resort on a below freezing day, and just the radiation, and even dark trees can do that. So take in consideration how much heat can be absorbed by dark things in the mountains, rock, sides of lodges, everything like that. They just flatten your airbag. You don't rise to the surface in a wet slide. They just steamroll you. Snowpack, crust, loose snow, spell avalanches, right? So crust, we've talked about this enough, that slick layers takes a while for the snow to adhere. It needs to hook up, or really loose snow. Just keep snowing. Is the snow actually sitting on top of anything solid at this point? Or is it just so faceted and the snow's all like sugar and filled with graphite? Weak layers, is it bonding or not? Like I was saying, there's just nothing better than traversing above your friend's traverse or a little small unsupported slope at the top of the ridge where you can't hurt you, can't do anything. Why would you ski by it if you could give it a kick or your snow shooting up the ridge? Give that thing a kick and see, is it bonding? Are there any weak layers? Is there any tension and propagation? Force tension compression and shear is your friend. This is how you kind of test things on the mountain as you go. You know, really great guys. They did full pit profiles, doing the whole deal, thermometers, probes, measuring it, the whole thing. If he doesn't get above his pit and put his skis on and physically test that thing, he's just riding the science program. I mean, you have to be more physical, and you have to try to get involved with overall connection of the snowpack to really get a handle on what the propagations and weak layers. Slabs, you got to start learning how to identify slabs if you're going to recreate in the mountains, start traveling in the mountains. There's soft slabs and hard slabs. And it's pretty neat. Like, you're skiing along or snowboarding along, and you're like, what's up with this thing? It looks like it's got a different texture to it. It might be smoother, it might have some wind effect, but all of a sudden it's like soft snow, I'm poking with my pole, powder, all of a sudden, hard layer. Huh. Looks like a big cookie on top of soft snow. And I put my pole through it, and hard, it punches through it. Oh, soft snow under it. Means it's a soft slab. It's something that guides and patrollers can kick out, or sometimes you can throw a bomb on them and kick them out. But they're really humbling. I mean, a lot of people do is they avoid the slab. Oh, don't touch the slab. Don't ski the right side of the chute. And then they go and ski below it. And then all of a sudden, a thing comes down on top of you. But so big slabs in a starting zone or in a chute or something like that, they should be avoided. You should just be like, nah, that's a big slab. Some guys can kick them out, and they know the perfect sweet spot to trigger the thing and just clean it, call it cutting and cleaning. But it's hard slabs, and I see this a lot with people. They're like, I'll ski cut the hard slab and kick it out. Hard slabs are where it's so hard you can't even put your ski pole through it, and when they break off, it sounds like a piece of dynamite. They really explode. There's so much energy. It's almost like glacier ice. How glacier ice explodes after a while when it starts warming. But slabs are what get a lot of people. So here's that surface ore I was telling you about, right? It's really beautiful. It sounds really nice when you're skiing it or when you're snow machining. It has this shh, it's like skiing broken glass. It feels good and looks good and sounds good, but at the end of the day, it never supports new snow very well. If you see this in the mountains, you're wanting the wind to come along and blow it over. You want them to knock the dominoes down, or you're hoping that it warms up and just melts it or glues it to the surface so it doesn't just sit there, a really loose feather domino sitting upright. Or that a bunch of skiers come through and ski it down and lay it down before the next storm. That's like 12 millimeter surface, or it's really big. Aspects, sun crust, and facets. I mean, all we're really talking about is what aspects catch up to most people more than others. You can identify south and east facing and west facing slopes sometimes just by how junky they look and how dirty they look. I mean, why does this snow look so beautiful and smooth and nice? It's north, it's northwest. And over here, south. And over here is west. Right? That massive sun crust underneath new snow in an unsupported slope. This would be the classic. There's certain mountains, right, for mountaineering, you climb up, and it's like, what aspect are you going to climb up to get up on top of Everest? Well, the route takes me generally up the south-facing slope. And you pick a good week or a good month, and you climb up the thing, and it's really beautiful and awesome. And you summit, you have to spend one night up high, and you wake up the next day and it's 60 degrees. And you're like, oh my gosh, did I pick the wrong aspect for this big mountaineering trip in the Himalayas? Or not? It'd be like this. I went up there when everything was frozen. It had all this appearance like this and that, but it didn't have this by any means. And I climbed up my route here, got on the ridge, and I come down and went, oh my gosh, do I even want to down climb this and risk this the same fire? No. I mean, really, like, the only route I would probably take would be this. This would be the most humbling hour you'd ever spend in your life just trying to get down onto this apex and try to get some more consistent snow. But, you know, generally you're just looking for stuff like this, roller balls, sun crust, avalanches have occurred a lot, multiple layers that are breaking out, and those are the places you want to avoid. So look and feel, and like I was saying, so much of this is simple. Without being a snow scientist, you can sometimes just say to yourself, what's falling out of the sky on my black jacket on the lift? And you're like, wow, an hour ago I had those big, beautiful flakes I love to see that I like to catch in my mouth that have fingers and branches, And now I just got these little tiny pins and needles. And now the temperature just dropped. Huh, pins and needles? It's like they don't hook up. You ever grab like pinyon tree pine needles? We used to get bags of them and put them on hills and slide down because they were like graphite when we were kids. But it's the same effect. You put them between your gloves and rub on them and they feel like graphite. Snow, it feels good. You put it between your glove and it just sticks together and it feels kind of grippy even. Snow that feels like ball bearings, like grapple, or pins and needles, or saucers, I call them. Anything like this, or like this, or like this, generally is a bad layer. You're like, wow, they're predicting 2 feet of snow, and right now it's grapple. Wow, if we get an inch of this grapple, ball bearings, and they get the 2 feet on top of it, we're going to see avalanches. Or if we get an inch of this of these saucers, or pins and needles, good snowflakes look like this. And a lot, most of the time around Cordova and Valdez, there's 50 of them stuck together before they even hit the ground. They're sticking together in the sky. That's great snow. But then it sits on the ground and goes to really broad temperature gradients. Oh, 45 degree days and 20 below nights. And it starts doing this. It starts breaking down. This crystal goes from this form to this form. Down to this, which really these come down and one goes this, this, and then this, and then this. And that's just facets. That's just sugar for no better term, and it just feels like graphite between your gloves. So much of this too is what you find on the ground could be the same properties. You look at it and you're like on a black glove or so much of it's not like you have to dig out this big snow study kit and get out your microscope. So much of it can be really quick and hasty and you get a lot of information. So, learn to identify weak layers. I mean, you don't have to be this guy. He's got 1,000 snow pits on the Front Range of Colorado for his thesis, for his study. This is a lot of talented people in this group, by the way. But it's easy for any Joe to just dig a pit and open up the snow and see it. If you open up the snow, or gosh, let's say a snowblower goes through and cuts through a parking lot has not been touched all year and not been driven on by snow machines or anything else, and it opens it up 8 feet. You can drive by, and most often, weak layers pop out as darker gray or shinier layers, or kind of a shinier blue layer. And you'll see them, Mike, as if you cut the tree in half and you see the rings of the tree. And you'll be like, oh, there's the drought 100 years ago. Of course, it's much simpler than that with snow. And you're just like, oh, I wonder what that layer's doing. You really notice it. But, you know, you get in there, you dig the pit, you dig the wall, just take your gloves. You know, guys like Mark would use a fine brush, and maybe get real detail. Just something you can do often and timely is what we're talking about, so you will do it. You just brush your fingers. Oh, that feels pretty consistent. Down here, like, what's this funky layer? Oh, there's a sun crust. There's a lens. Go down below that. Gosh, what's up with this snow? I can blow the snow out with the wind off my hand. Oh, great. 3 feet on top of a really, really rotted layer. And so much of it's just really a quick glance that you get so much information. You know, and I won't go into detail on how to dig a pit because it's getting kind of late, but you know, he's going to isolate a column with a saw and he's going to do this. This is how they teach you to do it. 10 wrists, right? So I cut out and make it's about a 12 inch area. You kind of cut it this way so it's angled so you don't wedge it and keep your shear wedged in there so you want it to react accordingly. You cut it this way and then you put your shovel behind it and you pull shears and you pull on it. And does it get a weak layer and a shear? Here's the one I have a hard time buying into is tapping it. And this is called a compression test. So I take this and I isolate it and I do 10 wrists. I put my shovel on here and I tap it with my glove on my hand. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Nope, nothing went. And then I do 10 wrists. 1, 2, 3, 10. And then nothing went. I go for shoulder. 1, 2, 3. Oh, everything checks out. Everything's fine. I really have a hard time thinking that a little 12 inch by 12 inch thing is going to give me enough information for me to go ski 50 miles an hour and put real G's on top of the snow and really put some weight on it. And then that's going to do a lot for me. It's really good stuff as long as you use it more as a baseline tool. But I really would love to see, you know, love to see guides do all that, get all that. This is more like data, long-term information for predicting snowpack into the future of the season. I'd love to see them get do all that, do this, and then grab their skis and climb above their pit, put their skis on, and then go, I'm just going to test it. Nothing. And he does it 3 or 4 times. And I've dug many pits where I had no compressions and no shears, and I got above my pit and I jumped on it with weight and some energy, and it just cracked, 20-foot crack, and I slid down into my hole. And I'm like, what the heck? And that's the thing with snow, it's just so unique and dynamic that, you know, getting a little more physical with it is such a great way to go. And there's nothing better than a big rock like this with full accumulation on it. And you can see weak layers because if the wind is blowing in the mountains like it usually does, all the layers that actually were eroded out by the wind, they'll be indented, are your weaker layers. And you can look at it from 20 feet away and be like, wow, look at that. I have a weak layer at 4 feet, a weak layer at 5 feet, and a weak layer at 9 feet. And it's been eroded by the wind. And I love to get on these and slam them and jump on them and give them a kick, or better yet, have someone grab a ski on one side of the mushroom rock and another, and just dig a ski into it. All right, let's pull on it. And all of a sudden, it just, you pull on it, it cracks, but the thing takes off with energy because it just releases so much energy too. Then you're like, wow. I'm talking, this is important for big picture stuff, forecasters, you know, snow safety directors. But things that you can do all the time timely is more of a hasty pit. And then what I was talking about with that ski pole probe, I stick it in. All I'm trying to do is open up the snow. And it's neat if I can get a plug to come out in one solid piece and I can burp it and see if there's weak layers. But this is something I can do all the time timely. It takes 5 minutes to dig a hasty pit. You can go down 3 or 4 feet. On anywhere from like 25 to 40 degree slope, dig down, do your shovels, do your shears with your hands, and then do that corner test, and then just maybe climb above it and hammer it. The stuff you can do all the time and timely, you can do it from every safe zone that you stop in. And the saying is it's so wonderful to check snow, stability of snowpack at different elevations and at different aspects as you're moving through the mountains. And then you're actually getting real information. You're not just going off, oh, I dug my snow pit this morning. We're good to go, guys. Let's just keep going. Hasties and cutting traverses and hitting mushroom rocks and unsupported little small slopes is such a great tool. Visual observations is key. And this was a big accident. This was a bunch of people killed. And it was a big fracture. So that's about 8 feet deep right here. It only snowed a foot and a half. And yet, this guy was definitely thinking low angle, let's go low angle. He comes into here. If there was anything you could learn from it, you're like, why didn't he realize that this concave was so filled up and loaded by the wind? But there's some clues here. And see the wind striking behind the rocks? You can tell the wind was blowing this way. Because you can tell that this big rock right here, the wind was blasting it and created like an eddy behind it. And of course left that wind stripe, and then I could tell the wind was coming from that direction and probably would have loaded that bowl. So sometimes it's, you know, an easy mistake. I'm flying in a helicopter going to go do this run, and I might be flying too close to the terrain, or I maybe didn't even look. But it's just so important to pay attention as you're driving in or riding up the lift or flying in, whatever you're doing. But at the end of the day, they ended up getting a lot of people caught in a massive avalanche here. It turned into a big, horrible situation. What could you do differently? Well, you could avoid the slope altogether, or you could start connecting the dots. But I do believe backcountry protocol is so wonderful. No matter what you're doing, if it's a helicopter or a ski lift, you still want to be kind of thinking skiing one at a time, safe zone to safe zone, and spotting one another. And I always love this. I love to see my ski partner come into me skiing, and if I have a really good safe zone, I even have a vantage point where it would have taken him. Because a physical search is much better than a blind search. If I pull out this wonderful technology like an avalanche transceiver, but I have a physical idea where the guy is, it's generally a pretty good outcome and I move pretty quick. If you get down into deposition looking for somebody and you don't know where they're at all, it takes a long time. But in this case, I think these guys maybe could have done a pickup here and just, the guy could have gone out here and dug a pit and said, what do you think? And I don't like it, come back. Well, guys, sorry for such a short run, let's get out of here. Or maybe you get to here, and then one guy goes to here, and then one guy goes to here. and then you'll have 1% slope at a time that would have been set a catastrophic event. We had 8 people caught in an avalanche. But no matter what you're doing, I still believe if you're in mid and high alpine terrain where their avalanches occur, you need these backcountry protocols. Signs of instability is everybody experienced cracking, collapsing, and wolfing. Definitely because the makes the hair stand up on your back, and it's definitely time to start striking away. You know, little slopes like this, I always call more like test slopes. I'd rather just ski traverse across this and hammer it a couple times with some big jumps while I'm doing about 10 miles an hour. Because where I'm going here is entire, I'm actually going to ski these little bladed slopes, and I get to this thing called waterfall, and they're pretty steep, real stuff. And it'd be nice to get some information before I get to waterfall to tell me if I should do waterfall or not do waterfall. You know, this is getting a lot of people. This is the place where the girls in Rico, Colorado just came up, and they just wanted to have lunch. They're looking to get out of the wind a little bit. There's a little roly-poly hill, but it was a convex. And they sat down and just folded over them. But they're good test slopes, and they also deserve respect. Physical signs of weakness. These guys were going up to Wolverine Cirque, and they just wanted to test it. And they did, and they got enough information to say, let's go back to Brighton. Let's go ski groomers today or some gladed slopes around, you know, Brighton ski resort. But they got to a place where it couldn't take them anywhere. They just came off the ridge and like a little slope that went into the flats where it couldn't run and take off. And they were like, 1, 2, 3, and it went. So we've touched on this enough, and this has got to be tattooed to your brain by now, but the human factor in this is following your instincts. There's so much junk in the way anymore with what we're thinking in the mountains. You know, foot partners are like, come on, let's go. The feeding frenzy's going off. I haven't got to ski because I hurt my knee last year or did snow much last year. You know, if you're the first skier or if you're a member of the group, everyone's opinion matters. It is time to re-gauge everything. It's like you're about to ski on a big slope, and you're like, what do you think? You're like, I don't know. The wind blew pretty hard 2 days ago. Strength 1. How about you, Jim? I don't know what to think. What do you think, Dean? I'm willing to go first, but I don't know what it is. I just want to get everyone's opinion on this. And then Harry says, what about the big rock at the bottom? If this thing slides, isn't it going to take us into the rock? And it just was the one thing I needed to hear to be like, no way. But tap into your instincts. And here's a good way to do it is get away from people after you've kind of sat there and you've got everybody's thoughts and opinions or concerns. And then you are going to be the first guy in. Look across the mountains and look for any clue at all that would tell you this is not a good idea. You're like, gosh, anything at all. A cornice that fell off over here, a serac fall over here, or an avalanche here, or a point release. Or wind striping where I didn't notice it before. Anything to tell me, like, I don't know what it is about the slope. But what it is then the next thing you tap into, like, who am I going to put at risk if something goes wrong here? My guides, my family, my ski partner, whatever it is. You know, how bad will this really be if this goes wrong? And it's not that you want to be, like, warm and fuzzy and feel so responsible for everything else in life, because let's face it, skiing is a pretty hedonistic sport. But by being responsible to everything you're responsible to in life helps you slow down just enough to tap into your inner instincts. And it'll tell you something with inside you. And so many people don't do that. It's getting pretty fast out there. People are pretty hungry. But you got to somehow slow it down enough to tap into your animal instincts. How your decisions can affect others. This is that tourniquet arm slide. This guy's avalanche transceiver is in his backpack with the receipt. Don't tell me out of 100 people at the bottom of this massive slope that had a three-mile fracture that was 50 feet deep, somebody out of those 100 people down there snow machining had to have said, like, gosh, this is a big slope, and it's been snowing a lot in February. And if this whole thing went, would it hurt or kill somebody? I mean, somewhere in this big party of people, what was it? Like, 9 people got killed in 1 day on this thing? His friends are trying to find him. Hang fire usually isn't that big a deal. Hang fire is like the fracture line that's left behind after an avalanche. But how about a 50-foot fracture line? I mean, one small chunk could be a school bus. And these guys are trying to find this guy. I mean, he didn't get found until August. I mean, he put his friends at risk by not being responsible, by not having his transceiver on, by not following his instincts at the bottom and saying, I'm not high marking this slope. There's too many people around. There's too much action to have, you know, good protocol. Most accidents are similar. This guy called the hotline. The avalanche danger was high. They had swept off some avalanches off the road. He had to wait for some avalanches to get swept off the road. Strike two. The wind was blowing massively, loading slow. Strike three. That's what would have been the turnaround, go home and start basing the bird. This was Thanksgiving in Utah years ago. I'm not doing anything big. I'm just going to go up a small slope. I'm just going to get a little exercise before I have Thanksgiving. And he didn't do anything that wrong, except for one little thing was ignoring the strikes. And then two, he actually was going really low angle terrain. He was in trees that don't slide at all because they just are really tight and nice. He ended up going over a little bit of apex over the ridge, which probably where he should have been the whole time anyways, right on the apex. He went over it a little bit. He was actually just going to go a little bit further than traverse and cut back. And it was a little bit of a concave. And, of course, the wind was blowing this way and loaded that concave. And there was a train trap below him, so he had all these things that really caught up to him. So it was just really sad. But pick the right day. Recent snow, rain, wind, or changing temperatures, spell avalanche. Really pay attention to what happened out there. And this is our, this is you guys' backyard. Pretty amazing mountains that you got. But anything at all, when you get a vantage point or when you start looking at what happens with the elements, you know, be your own forecaster and decide where you're willing to go, what you're going to do. Route selection is everything. And really get everybody on top of where you're going and what you're doing. Have the plan figured out between the group. You know, what's this girl doing? She's texting probably. They're talking about the stock market. Who knows what they're talking about? They're looking at some mountain pontoon peak out here. Who knows what they're doing, right? And poor Hillary's got her hands full. She's just got to tell every single person what the plan is and where they're going to park in the safe zone and how they're going to do what and where. That's not how it should be. It should definitely be tightened up a bit. And everybody should be hearing the same thing all at the same time. That way all the gears are engaged and somebody might bring out a concern and help, you know. It's not up to just the guide or the guy who's going first or the most experienced person. Everyone matters. It's really this trying to get as much information and as much concern brought out in the group as possible. You know, visual and verbal. If you're visual and or verbal, you're king. I can say, Dean, hands in front, before I crash and lose my ski. And then I'm looking for it, and then you're like, hey, come on, help me find my ski. And then you read the newspaper, but you guys caught an avalanche. No one really knew what led up to it, but it's generally those little things like that that happen. So, and one thing I didn't say about strike 1, 2, 3 methodology is on a strike 2 day, I want to pick a route that gives me the ability visual and verbal, which means I can say, hey, Jim, watch out for the snag, the tree branch hanging below, or whatever. I'm really trying to nip the possibility of an injury, too. That way we can stay on the really safe terrain and not have to be like, oh, you're all injured, your knee's blown, and your ski's lost, and we're going to have to scurry out of here and cross 4 slide paths to get back to where we want to be. The visual and verbal is so nice. Ready for the changeup. Watch out for the changeup. It's kind of icy here. Is anything to prevent the crash or the guy tumbling or losing the ski or breaking a knee or something? You know, don't let your equipment be your demise. I mean, how much can you really carry on your back and still be a good, safe skier and not put too much weight on your ligaments and your knees? I mean, just the leverage game, first of all, we put this leverage on our body, and it's already pretty much trying to challenge every cable and all of our joints, let alone a 40-pound pack. So be realistic. You know, I would carry an airbag if I didn't have to carry a whole glacier kit. Since I have to carry a rope, ice axe, crampons, can I really afford to add another 8 pounds to my back? No, I think I'd be putting my friends and my clients at risk because I'd have like a 45-pound pack at that point. I can see with like a 32 or 28-pound pack, no problem. But going up is a strike. Majority of this gear goes in my flight bag, and I carry just what I need for the mountains. And it ends up being something I can realistically carry. And then I just ski accordingly, too. I try not to be a rock star when I have a heavy pack. Just ski smart. So visual search, like I said earlier, is a good outcome. A blind search is generally a bad outcome. Practical gear, be practical. I had a guy years ago, this was before airbags were even really popular. He had this bag, he must have weighed 140, and he had this airbag. And I couldn't tell him he couldn't use it, because you know, I'm the lead guide and I'm the owner of the company. But the last thing I need to do is create liability for him, me, or anything else. I'm like, gosh, Doug, your pack's pretty heavy, you know, you want to lighten it up a little bit? Oh, I already did. I was like, I mean, it was 40 pounds. And I regret maybe not calling him out, or maybe I shouldn't have put him in the field at all. But he ends up jumping a little tiny cornice, like 4 feet. He blows both knees because the pack just takes over. And next thing you know, he's now got four groups, all of them are at risk because we're now rescuing the guy. And it was just one of those things that wasn't very practical, is what it came down to. Well, that worked. It's all, we're pretty much done. I'll just hit this last couple. Pretty much the majority of everything anyway, but let's just see if it's going to work. So always have an escape route planned. Always think, like, if something slides where you're going to end up. This is a little dynamic, but if I was to ski this, I would definitely be going, there's my safe zone, there's my safe zone. And I did this years ago. I actually triggered that. And, of course, I made my safe zone. It just went over my head. But you really got to always have a place to go in case it happens. And even if you're not going to go there, you just know where it is and you have it in the back of your head that you're going to go there. Because you just can't even miss that moment. If you have to think for a second, probably it's not going to work out for you. So always think about that safe zone. Sometimes it's just like the big, big, beautiful left, kind of a quick right. And it's that double fall line where you might be a snow machiner and instead of, you know, side hilling way right away from the apex of the ridge, you just kind of side hill more left a little bit. Right. And you just keep your eye on the safe zone, the prize, so to speak. I believe this is necessary equipment anymore for most ski resorts, most snow machining endeavors, snowshoeing endeavors. Probe, shovel, and avalanche transceiver. The way they work is, as long as the battery is over 60%, that's good. They work a long time. You could go like 2 months, skiing like 8 hours, 9 hours a day, and your battery will still be above 60 in most cases. It belongs on your body with your shell over it. In case something happens, it's really protected and can't come off your body. And turn it on, keep it on. Batteries last a long time. A lot of people go to the restroom and turn it off or go to lunch and turn it off. Don't. Just put it on, turn it on, keep it on. Double check everybody before you go in the mountains. Just one guy should go stand 30 feet away and everybody just comes walking by you one at a time and just check and make sure everybody's turned on. Probes and shovels, I do believe they belong in your rucksack. Don't trust a Fastex buckle or a bungee to your friend's life. If we both go through the washing machine together and I end up on the surface and I find you with my transceiver, next thing I'm like, where's my probe? And it's lost. So that stuff, your pack should be secured on your back pretty darn good so it can't come off and protect your spine, but also so you don't lose your gear. Always cross slopes one at a time. He's going to get over to that tree. And he's going to put two poles up, and he's going to spot me. And if he's got a really good spot, he would see where that slope would carry me in case it slid, and that we'd have a really good physical idea where to go. Do the math on safe zones. Like, if this slope was much shorter than it is, let's say this fractured right here and the avalanche came down. Would it actually have enough speed to jump me? Probably not. It would probably just come down and stuff me. But since this slope had a good 400 or 500 feet above it, absolutely had enough time to get enough speed that would be a good safe zone. But, you know, sometimes you're just behind a tree and your tips and your tails of your skis are sticking out. Or some guys will hide behind a big rock, but the front of the snow machine is actually not in a safe zone. So really, really qualify your safe zones. Implement good backcountry protocols. Tell people where you're going. Carry appropriate safety equipment. This is a biggie, the extra water, food, clothing. I mean, this is the deal. Like, oh, we're just going up to Mount Eak. We don't need a lunch or we don't need an extra shirt. You do, because at the end of the day, when something goes wrong, it's not a half a day. The rescuer becomes a victim pretty quick. It's really hard for people to see this, but you know, the guy that breaks his leg generally goes off in the ambulance, goes to the hospital, and an hour later he's eating a hamburger. And his friend, who drug him all night long and got soaking wet and cold, they're trying to save his life from hypothermia. And it happens a lot this way. So being pressurized and having good water in your body, just you can take a bigger hit. You're less likely to hurt your ligaments and muscles. Having food, you just think better. Your muscles are better. You got some fuel to burn and a little extra clothing in case it turns into an epic. Travel with a partner. Keep your partner in sight. Maintain visual and verbal. Pick routes that provide the ability to be visual and verbal, right? It's all about the route. Only expose one person at a time on the slope and spot that person. Never cross above your partner. And nowadays, just think about who's coming in above you. You could ski the chute, or you could do a lot of things, but anymore, there's so many people in the backcountry and the side country that really pay attention to where you're at opposed to where other people are. Have an escape route planned. Like I was saying, like sometimes it's you're skiing that big chute or that big bowl because you trust the snow, but why not kind of keep your eye on the prize? If the safe zone is left and that's the apex ridge, why not just do big, beautiful lefts and kind of quick rides? And it's even more fun. It's even more dynamic. Really get out of the way at the bottom. Do the math on what 30,000 tons can do and how far it can travel. Really get out to the side. Even better yet. Cornices and seracs can slide bigger than you ever thought possible. There's so much mass and weight, and they're so slippery that they'll travel down the mountain, across the glacier, and up the other side. They're even worse than big avalanches a lot of times. And the evolution of safe protocols is not, it's all of us engaging the idea and expecting more of ourselves and our partners and teaching our kids and our friends. More of the terrain management type stuff so we can avoid avalanches. But thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Any questions or you want to shoot a hole in any of this?
Well, thanks a lot, Dean.
Really appreciate it. Sorry that went a little bit long.
It's okay.
Kind of hit some extra points with you guys since we live in Valdez and Cordova.
Well, it's great having a talk that's not just strictly based on snow pit science and snow physics, but on what a guy like me can do every day when I'm just touring. Yeah. It's the heads-up attitude that I really appreciate your approach.
And we did this together once. We went and did a course here, and then we did a field day, and yeah. We hiked to the top of Mount Yak, and it was all those things. One guy showed up, didn't have any equipment, one guy didn't have a pack, one guy was out of shape and didn't think he could make it. We just did what needed to happen. We're like, oh no, I'll take the guy that doesn't think he can make it up the mountain and we'll just go really slow. And so he got up and learned a lot. All the variables happened right that day. Mixed abilities, people showing up without equipment, showing up with too much equipment. It was one of those things. But we did what needed to happen, and everyone got up to the top and learned a lot, and we had a really fun day. It was almost one of those, like, it would have been easy to throw in the towel. Well, if you don't think you can make it, you're not going, and since you brought too much gear, you'll never make it to the ridge, and that's kind of what happened. But it was pretty fun that we did that with so many different people. That was a fun day. And he pretty much let out the local, so it's cool.
You know, one thing I wonder is how to engage, like, some of the snow machiners around here. There's a lot of young kids that, you know, have big mountain machines, and God, they just seem to have either no memory or very short term about, you know, what's happened here in the past. And,
yeah,
you know, boy, they just take off ripping around on these bad days, and they can get, it seems like so fast they can get into some real...
No, it'll put you in trouble because you'll be out there trying to help them. Yeah. It's insane what's going on. I mean, tailgate Alaska and Valdez nowadays, it's not the easiest. It's drug sex, rock and roll,
really.
It's so crazy. I don't want it there, but it's there. But it's a pretty good lesson to go sit on Thompson Pass and climb a path up a mountain and just watch the scene. here's 100 things you should never do in the mountains, and there's 1,000 of people doing it. that's why we need to do this, you know? Like,
yeah, it'd be interesting if we, I don't know what the, how to do that, but it seems like, you know, you got these crops of younger kids coming up that, you know, maybe have a little bit of knowledge or yeah, maybe none at all, but they see everybody else doing it and just, you know, take off. And,
you know, the best way to get the young people to do it is I do a film sometimes before this. You guys are probably falling asleep by now because this runs a little bit longer. When I have younger people or if I'm in a ski town, I do a 15-minute video. And I translate this all into how all this train management crosses over into performance skiing and riding and stuff. How great skiers never just pick a big, huge run. A great skier has like a double fall line. And he may not even use it, but it's there in case the snow changes or a slide happens. He skis up against the terrain and slows down, and he naturally, he's not fighting gravity. And he looks so good and smooth because of it. But he's also kind of putting himself on an island of safety by taking the apex or the high point. That's the best way to get those guys engaged, really, is, no, we'll talk about terrain management and how you become even a better performer on the mountain. You're going to ride faster, go bigger, everything, and they'll start absorbing some of that way. We didn't have any heroes. Okay. Kind of expected a few.
Yeah.
Is your son, does he get out in the mountains?
Daughters, yeah. Not so much.
Her mind was engaged, though, that's for sure.
We're hoping for some snow, it's been
Yeah.
We'll get some.
Yeah, you talk about the human factor. I haven't skied in 2 seasons, basically, because the snow's been so crappy, you know, so if it happens, everybody's going to be
a snow machine on a baby's lip.
It's scary, yes. Huh? Like, I flew a heli tour from Denver all the way to Valdez, and there was no snow all the way to Juneau in February. And last year, I flew a jet on a perfect bluebird day, just at Alaska Airlines. There was no snow all the way to Valdez. Nothing touching the ocean. The geese haven't left none of the coast area for years now. It's, grass is growing.
I think it's killing a lot of black bears, and there's no snow down low over the dens. And,
is that right?
There's just a real lack of black bears, and we've had these really mild winters, and I wonder if they're just expending too much energy trying to, you know, to get wet, or I don't know.
Maybe, because the snow is an insulator, protects it from the rain. It might be, because
the brown bears.
I thought that too with the rain last year. Bear to do in this den when it floods.
Mm-hmm.
Where's he going from there? Nowhere.
Yeah, or they get up and then there's nothing to eat.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was hearing about the pop. I know that the bear baiting and the poaching and the sound is out of hand since Whittier tunnels.
Yeah. All the people from Whittier, from Anchorage through Whittier.
And that's been a problem in the sound, but it seems like now it's happening over here. There's not that much.
I'm seeing about these. I didn't see the blackies like I normally
do.
Well, up where I'm at Child's Glacier, there's bumper crop this year. All over the place.
Bears?
Black bear and brown bear both.
Uh-huh.
You know. But last year I had 10 hunters out there running around after bear. This year, not even one. So I think it has a lot to do with the hunting. Because there were almost no bears to be seen. I've got video after video after video after video of bears this year out there.
Well, my wife and I rode on the jet, and at Juneau, the famous bear researcher from Alaska, Park, LeVon from Fish and Game, he's the man for like the last 30 years. And he told us that it's food cycles. And the reason we haven't seen... They haven't seen a lot of bears in Yakutat either this summer. And he said because the food cycle is keeping them higher for whatever reason. And I have seen bears, a few bears up high, but none down on the salmon streams here in town. So I don't know. He doesn't think that the bear populations are actually that much lower. Maybe in the sound or, you know, in specific spots, but he thinks food cycles.
It's been less seen around town, at least from...
Yeah, oh, totally. Yeah, there's less bears around this year.
I wonder what did it. There's some durable and tough, like, dying off, a bunch of them are dying, or it's just... kind of like rabbits, you know, they live longer than that. Yeah, I don't know, it's weird. It's definitely weird, the weather. It's crazy.
Yeah.
The moose are higher than I've ever seen them. I got my moose at 4,000 feet this year. I'm sorry. I couldn't find a bull down low. They were just all up high. I started glassing up high. I'm like, oh, there they all are. Well, this will be an epic.
Changes.
I didn't see mine until they closed it.
Oh, yeah. Were you hunting up the river?
Well, I was hauling people back and forth to the glacier, and they closed it after, 10 days? Mm-hmm. And day 11, this young bull walks out and stands right in front of the van and says, hi there.
And I'll sign one of those if you'd like, wallpaper.